This is Audible.
Audible Studios presents The Assassin's Blade, The Throne of Glass novellas. Written by Sarah J. Maas. Narrated by Elizabeth Evans.
Chapter 1. Seated in the council room of the Assassin's Keep, Selena Sardothian leaned back in her chair. "It's past 4 in the morning," she said, adjusting the folds of her crimson silk dressing gown and crossing her bare legs beneath the wooden table. This had better be important.
"Perhaps if you hadn't been reading all night, you wouldn't be so exhausted," snapped the young man seated across from her.
She ignored him and studied the 4 other people assembled in the underground chamber. All male, all far older than she, and all refusing to meet her stare. A chill that didn't have to do with the drafty room ran down her spine. Picking at her manicured nails, Selena schooled her features into neutrality. The 5 assassins gathered at the long table, including herself, were 5 of Aerobin Hommel's 7 most trusted companions. This meeting was undeniably important. She'd known that from the moment the serving girl pounded on her door, insisting Selena come downstairs and not even bother to get dressed. When Aerobin summoned you, you didn't keep him waiting. Thankfully, her sleepwear was as exquisite as her daytime wardrobe, and cost nearly as much. Still, being 16 in a room with men made her keep an eye on the neckline of her robe. Her beauty was a weapon, one she kept honed, but it could also be a vulnerability. Aerobin Hommel, king of the assassins, lounged at the head of the table, his auburn hair shining in the light from the glass chandelier. His silver eyes met hers, and he frowned. It might have just been the late hour, but Selena could have sworn that her mentor was paler than usual. Her stomach twisted.
"Grigori's been caught,"
Aerobin finally said. "Well, that would explain one person missing from this meeting.
His mission was a trap. He's now being held in the royal dungeons."
Selena sighed through her nose. This was why she'd been awakened? She tapped a slippered foot on the marble floor. "Then kill him," she said.
She'd never liked Grigori anyway.
When she was 10, she'd fed his horse a bag of candy, and he'd thrown a dagger at her head for it. She'd caught the dagger, of course. And ever since, Grigori had borne the scar on his cheek from her return throw.
"Kill Grigori?" demanded Sam,
the young man seated at Aerobin's left, a place that usually went to Ben, Aerobin's second in command. Selena knew very well what Sam Cortland thought of her. She'd known since they were children, when Aerobin took her in and declared her, not Sam, to be his protege and heir. That hadn't stopped Sam from trying to undermine her at every turn. And now, at 17, Sam was still a year older than she, and he still hadn't forgotten that he would always be second best. She bristled at the sight of Sam in Ben's seat. Ben would probably throttle Sam for it when he arrived, or she could just save Ben the effort and do it herself. Selena looked to Aerobin. Why hadn't he reprimanded Sam for sitting in Ben's place? Aerobin's face, still handsome despite the silver starting to show in his hair, remained impassive. She hated that unreadable mask, especially when controlling her own expressions and temper remained a tad difficult. "If Grigori's been caught," Selena drawled, brushing back a strand of her long golden hair, "then the protocol's simple. Send an apprentice to slip something into his food. Nothing painful," she added as the men around her tensed. "Just enough to silence him before he talks."
Which Grigori might very well do if he was in the royal dungeons.
Most criminals who went in there never came out again. Not alive. And not in any recognizable shape. The location of the Assassin's Keep was a well-guarded secret, one she'd been trained to keep until her last breath. But even if she didn't, no one was likely to believe that an elegant manor house on a very respectable street in Rifthold was home to some of the greatest assassins in the world. What better place to hide than in the middle of the capital city?
"And if he's already talked?"
challenged Sam. "And if Grigori's already talked," she said, "then kill everyone who heard." Sam's brown eyes flashed as she gave him a little smile that she knew made him irate. Selena turned to Aerobin. "But you didn't need to drag us here to decide this. You already gave the order, didn't you?" Aerobin nodded, his mouth a thin line. Sam choked back his objection and looked toward the crackling hearth beside the table. The firelight cast the smooth, elegant panes of Sam's face into light and shadow. A face, she'd been told, that could have earned him a fortune if he'd followed in his mother's footsteps. But Sam's mother had opted instead to leave him with assassins, not courtesans, before she died. Silence fell, and a roaring noise filled her ears as Arobin took a breath. Something was wrong. What else? She asked, leaning forward. The other assassins focused on the table. Whatever had happened, they knew. Why hadn't Arobin told her first? Arobin's silver eyes became steel.
Ben was killed.
Selena gripped the arms of her chair. What?
Ben.
Ben, the ever-smiling assassin who had trained her as often as Arobin had.
Ben,
who had once mended her shattered right hand.
Ben,
the seventh and final member of Arobin's inner circle. He was barely 30 years old. Selena's lips pulled back from her teeth.
What do you mean, killed?
Arobin eyed her, and a glimmer of grief flashed across his face. 5 years Ben's senior, Arobin had grown up with Ben. They'd been trained together. Ben had seen to it that his friend became the unrivaled king of the assassins, and never questioned his place as Arobin's second. Her throat closed up.
It was supposed to be Grigori's mission,
Arobin said quietly.
I don't know why Ben was involved, or who betrayed them. They found his body near the castle gates.
Do you have his body? She demanded. She had to see it. Had to see him one last time. See how he'd died. How many wounds it had taken to kill him.
No,
Arobin said.
Why the hell not?
Her fists clenched and unclenched.
Because the place was swarming with guards and soldiers,
Sam burst out, and she whipped her head to him.
How do you think we learned about this in the first place?
Arobin had sent Sam to see why Ben and Grigori were missing?
If we'd grabbed his body,
Sam said, refusing to back down from her glare.
It would have led them right to the keep.
You're assassins, she growled at him. You're supposed to be able to retrieve a body without being seen.
If you'd been there, you would have done the same.
Selena pushed her chair back so hard it flipped over.
If I'd been there, I would have killed all of them to get Ben's body back.
She slammed her hands on the table, rattling the glasses. Sam shot to his feet, a hand on the hilt of his sword.
Oh, listen to you, ordering us about like you run the guild.
But not yet, Selena. He shook his head.
Not yet. Enough!
Arobin snapped, rising from his chair. Selena and Sam didn't move. None of the other assassins spoke, though they gripped their various weapons. She'd seen firsthand what fights at the keep were like. The weapons were as much for the bearer's own safety as they were to prevent her and Sam from doing serious damage to each other.
I said enough!
If Sam took one step toward her, drew his sword a fraction of an inch, that concealed dagger in her robe would find itself a new home in his neck. Arobin moved first, grabbing Sam's chin in one hand, forcing the young man to look at him.
Check yourself, or I'll do it for you, boy,
he murmured.
You're a fool for picking a fight with her tonight.
Selena bit down on her reply. She could handle Sam tonight, or any other night for that matter. If it came down to a fight, she'd win. She always beat Sam. But Sam released the hilt of his sword. After a moment, Arobin removed his grip on Sam's face, but didn't step away. Sam kept his gaze on the floor as he strode to the far side of the council room. Crossing his arms, he leaned against the stone wall. She could still reach him. One flick of her wrist and his throat would spout blood.
Selena,
Arobin said, his voice echoing in the silent room. Enough blood had been spilled tonight. They didn't need another dead assassin.
Ben.
Ben was dead and gone. And she'd never again run into him in the halls of the keep. He'd never set her injuries with his cool, deft hands. Never coax a laugh from her with a joke or a lewd anecdote.
Selena,
Arobin warned again.
I'm done,
Selena snapped. She rolled her neck, running a hand through her hair. She stalked to the door, but paused on the threshold.
Just so you know, she said,
speaking to all of them but still watching Sam.
I'm going to retrieve Ben's body.
A muscle feathered in Sam's jaw, though he wisely kept his eyes averted.
But don't expect me to extend the same courtesy to the rest of you when your time comes.
with that. She turned on her heel and ascended the spiral staircase to the manor above. 15 minutes later, no one stopped her when she slipped out the front gate and into the silent city streets. Chapter 2. 2 months, 3 days, and about 8 hours later, the clock on the mantel chimed noon. Captain Rolf, Lord of the Pirates, was late. Then again, so were Selena and Sam, but Rolf had no excuse, not when they were already 2 hours behind schedule. Not when they were meeting in his office. And it wasn't her fault for being tardy. She couldn't control the winds, and those skittish sailors had certainly taken their time sailing into the archipelago of the Dead Islands. She didn't want to think about how much gold Aerobin had spent bribing a crew to sail into the heart of pirate territory. But Skull's Bay was on an island, so they hadn't really had a choice about their mode of transportation. Selena, concealed behind a far too stuffy black cloak, tunic, and ebony mask, rose from her seat before the pirate lord's desk. How dare he make her wait? He knew precisely why they were here, after all. 3 assassins had been found murdered by pirate hands, and Aerobin had sent her to be his personal dagger, to extract retribution, preferably the gold kind, for what their deaths would cost the Assassin's Guild. With every minute he makes us wait, Selena said to Sam, the mask making her words low and soft. I'm adding an extra 10 gold pieces to his debt. Sam, who didn't wear a mask over his handsome features, crossed his arms and scowled. You'll do no such thing. Aerobin's letter is sealed, and it's going to remain that way. Neither of them had been particularly happy when Aerobin announced that Sam would be sent to the Dead Islands with Selena, especially when Ben's body, which Selena had retrieved, had barely been in the ground for 2 months. The sting of losing him hadn't exactly worn off. Her mentor had called Sam an escort, but Selena knew what his presence meant. A watchdog. Not that she'd do anything bad when she was about to meet the pirate lord of Aurelia. It was a once-in-a-lifetime chance. Even though the tiny, mountainous island and ramshackle port city hadn't really made much of an impression so far. She'd been expecting a manor house like the Assassin's Keep, or at least a fortified aging castle, but the pirate lord occupied the entire top floor of a rather suspect tavern. The ceilings were low, the wooden floors creaked, and the cramped room combined with the already sizzling temperature of the southern islands meant Selena was sweating buckets beneath her clothing. But her discomfort was worth it. As they strode through Skull's Bay, heads had turned at the sight of her. The billowing black cape, the exquisite clothing, and the mask transformed her into a whisper of darkness. A little intimidation never did any harm. Selena walked to the wooden desk and picked up a piece of paper, her black gloved hands turning it over to read the contents. A weather log. How dull.
What are you doing?
Selena lifted another piece of paper. If his pirateness can't be bothered to clean for us, then I don't see why I can't have a look.
He'll be here any second, Sam hissed.
She picked up a flattened map, examining the dots and markings along the coastline of their continent. Something small and round gleamed beneath the map, and she slipped it into her pocket before Sam could notice.
Oh, hush,
she said, opening the hutch on the wall adjacent to the desk. With these creaky floors, we'll hear him a mile off. The hutch was crammed with rolled scrolls, quills, the odd coin, and some very old, very expensive-looking brandy. She pulled out a bottle, swirling the amber liquid in the sunlight streaming through the tiny porthole window.
Care for a drink?
No,
Sam snapped, half-twisting in his seat to watch the door.
Put it back, now.
She cocked her head, twirled the brandy once more in its crystal bottle, and set it down. Sam sighed. Beneath her mask, Selena grinned.
He can't be a very good lord, she said, if this is his personal office.
Sam gave a stifled cry of dismay as Selena plopped into the giant armchair behind the desk and set about opening the pirate's ledgers and turning over his papers. His handwriting was cramped and near illegible, his signature nothing more than a few loops and jagged peaks. She didn't know what she was looking for exactly. Her brows rose a bit at the sight of a piece of purple perfumed paper, signed by someone named Jacqueline. She leaned back in the chair, propping her feet on the desk, and read it.
Damn it, Selena!
She raised her brows, but realized he couldn't see. The mask and clothes were a necessary precaution, one that made it far easier to protect her identity. In fact, all of Arobin's assassins had been sworn to secrecy about who she was, under the threat of endless torture and eventual death. Selena huffed, though her breath only made the interior of the insufferable mask hotter. All that the world knew about Selena Sardothian, Otterlin's assassin, was that she was female, and she wanted to keep it that way. How else would she be able to stroll the broad avenues of Rifthold, or infiltrate grand parties by posing as foreign nobility? And while she wished that Rolf could have the chance to admire her lovely face, she had to admit that the disguise also made her rather imposing, especially when the mask warped her voice into a growling rasp.
Get back in your seat.
Sam reached for a sword that wasn't there. The guards at the entrance to the inn had taken their weapons. Of course, none of them had realized that Sam and Selena were weapons themselves. They could kill Rolf just as easily with their bare hands.
Or you'll fight me.
She tossed the love letter onto the desk.
Somehow, I don't think that'd make a favorable impression on our new acquaintances.
She crossed her arms behind her head, gazing at the turquoise sea visible between the dilapidated buildings that made up Skull's Bay. Sam half rose from his chair.
Just get back in your seat.
I've spent the past 10 days at sea. Why should I sit in that uncomfortable chair when this one's far more suited to my tastes?
Sam let out a growl. Before he could speak, the door opened. Sam froze, but Selena only inclined her head in greeting as Captain Rolf, Lord of the Pirates, entered his office.
I'm glad to see you've made yourself at home.
The tall, dark-haired man shut the door behind him. Bold move, considering who was waiting in his office. Selena remained where she sat. Well, he certainly wasn't what she'd expected. It wasn't every day that she was surprised, but she'd imagined him to be a bit dirtier, and far more flamboyant. Considering the tales she'd heard of Rolf's wild adventures, she had trouble believing that this man, lean but not wiry, well-dressed but not overtly so, and probably in his late 20s, was the legendary pirate. Perhaps he, too, kept his identity a secret from his enemies. Sam stood, bowing his head slightly.
Sam Cortland,
he said by way of greeting. Rolf extended a hand, and Selena watched his tattooed palm and fingers as they clasped Sam's broad hand. The map. That was the mythic map that he'd sold his soul to have inked on his hands. The map of the world's oceans. The map that changed to show storms, foes, and treasure.
I suppose you don't need an introduction.
Rolf turned to her.
No.
Selena leaned back farther in his desk chair.
I suppose I don't.
Rolf chuckled, a crooked smile spreading across his tanned face. He stepped to the hutch, giving her the chance to examine him further. Broad shoulders, head held high, a casual grace to his movements that came with knowing he had all the power here. He didn't have a sword either. Another bold move. Wise, too, given that they could easily use his weapons against him.
Brandy?
He asked.
No, thank you,
Sam said. Selena felt Sam's eyes hard upon her, willing her to take her feet off Rolf's desk.
With that mask on, Rolf mused, I don't think you could have a drink anyway.
He poured brandy for himself and took a long sip.
You must be boiling in all that clothing.
Selena lowered her feet to the ground as she ran her hands along the curved edge of his desk, stretching out her arms.
I'm used to it.
Rolf drank again, watching her for a heartbeat over the rim of his glass. His eyes were a striking shade of sea green, as bright as the water just a few blocks away. Lowering the glass, he approached the end of the desk.
I don't know how you handle things in the north, but down here, we like to know who we're speaking to.
She cocked her head.
As you said, I don't need an introduction. And as for the privilege of seeing my beautiful face, I'm afraid that's something few men receive.
Rolf's tattooed fingers tightened on the glass.
Get out of my chair.
Across the room, Sam tensed. Selena examined the contents of Rolf's desk again. She clicked her tongue, shaking her head.
You really need to work on organizing this mess.
She sensed the pirate grabbing for her shoulder and was on her feet before his fingers could graze the black wool of her cloak. He stood a good head taller than her.
I wouldn't do that if I were you, she crooned.
Rolf's eyes gleamed with a challenge.
You're in my city, and on my island.
Only a hand's breadth separated them.
You're not in any position to give me orders.
Sam cleared his throat, but Selena stared up into Rolf's face. His eyes scanned the blackness beneath the hood of her cloak, the smooth black mask, the shadows that concealed any trace of her features.
Selena?
Sam warned, clearing his throat again.
Very well.
She sighed loudly and stepped around Rolf as if he were nothing but a piece of furniture in her way. She sank into the chair beside Sam, who flashed her a glare that burned enough to melt the entirety of the frozen wastes. She could feel Rolf watching their every movement, but he merely adjusted the lapels of his midnight blue tunic before sitting down. Silence fell, interrupted only by the cry of gulls circling above the city, and the shouting of pirates calling to one another in the filthy streets.
Well?
Rolf rested his forearms on the desk. Sam glanced at her. Her move.
You know precisely why we're here, Selena said. But perhaps all that brandy's gone to your head. Shall I refresh your memory?
Rolf gestured with his green, blue, and black hand for her to continue, as if he were a king on his throne, listening to the complaints of the rabble. Ass.
Three assassins from our guild were found dead in Bellhaven. The one that got away told us they were attacked by pirates.
She draped an arm along the back of her chair.
Your pirates.
And how did the survivor know they were my pirates?
She shrugged.
Perhaps it was the tattoos that gave them away.
All of Rolf's men had their wrists tattooed with an image of a multicolored hand. Rolf opened a drawer in his desk, pulling out a piece of paper and reading the contents. He said,
Once I caught wind that Arob and Hamel might blame me, I had the shipyard master of Bellhaven send me these records. It seems the incident occurred at 3 a.m. at the docks.
This time Sam answered,
That's correct.
Rolf set down the paper and lifted his eyes skyward.
So, if it was 3 a.m, and it took place at the docks, which have no street lamps, as I'm sure you know.
She didn't.
Then how did your assassins see all of their tattoos?
Beneath her mask, Selena scowled.
Because it happened 3 weeks ago, during the full moon.
Ah, but it's early spring. Even in Bellhaven, nights are still cold. Unless my men were without coats, there was no way for-
Enough! Selena snapped. I suppose that piece of paper has 10 different paltry excuses for your men.
She grabbed the satchel from the floor and yanked out the 2 sealed documents.
These are for you.
She tossed them on the desk.
From our master.
A smile tugged on Rolf's lips, but he pulled the documents to him, studying the seal. He held it up to the sunlight.
I'm surprised it hasn't been tampered with.
His eyes glimmered with mischief. Selena could sense Sam's smugness oozing out of him. With 2 deft flicks of his wrist, Rolf sliced open both envelopes with a letter knife she somehow hadn't spotted.
How had she missed it? A fool's mistake.
In the silent minutes that passed as Rolf read the letters, his only reaction was the occasional drumming of his fingers on the wooden desk. The heat was suffocating, and sweat slipped down her back. They were supposed to be here for 3 days, long enough for Rolf to gather the money he owed them. Which, judging by the growing frown on Rolf's face, was quite a lot. Rolf let out a long breath when he finished, and shuffled the papers into alignment.
Your master drives a hard bargain,
Rolf said, looking from Selena to Sam.
But his terms aren't unfair. Perhaps you should have read the letter before you started flinging accusations at me and my men. There will be no retribution for those dead assassins, whose deaths, your master agrees, were not my fault in the least. He must have some common sense, then.
Selena quelled the urge to lean forward. If Arobin wasn't demanding payment for the death of those assassins, then what were they doing here? Her face burned.
She'd looked like a fool, hadn't she? If Sam smiled just the slightest bit.
Rolf drummed his inked fingers again and ran a hand through his shoulder-length dark hair.
As for the trade agreement he's outlined, I'll have my accountant draw up the necessary fees. But you'll have to tell Arobin that he can't expect any profits until at least the 2nd shipment. Possibly the 3rd. And if he has an issue with that, then he can come down here himself to tell me.
For once, Selena was grateful for the mask. It sounded like they'd been sent for some sort of business investment. Sam nodded at Rolf, as if he knew exactly what the pirate lord was talking about.
And when can we tell Aerobin to expect the first shipment? He asked.
Rolf stuffed Aerobin's letters into a desk drawer and locked it.
The slaves will be here in 2 days, ready for your departure the day after. I'll even loan you my ship, so you can tell that trembling crew of yours they're free to return to Rifthold tonight, if it pleases them.
Selena stared at him. Aerobin had sent them here for slaves? How could he stoop so disgustingly low? And to tell her she was going to Skull's Bay for one thing, but to really send her here for this? She felt her nostrils flare. Sam had known about this deal, but he'd somehow forgotten to mention the truth behind their visit, even during the 10 days they'd spent at sea. As soon as she got him alone, she'd make him regret it. But for now, she couldn't let Rolf catch on to her ignorance.
You'd better not botch this, Selena warned the pirate lord. Aerobin won't be pleased if anything goes awry.
Rolf chuckled.
You have my word that it will all go according to plan. I'm not Lord of the Pirates for nothing, you know.
She leaned forward, flattening her voice into the even tones of a business partner concerned about her investment.
How long exactly have you been involved in the slave trade?
It couldn't have been long. Otterlin had only started capturing and selling slaves 2 years ago, most of them prisoners of war from whatever territories dared rebel against their conquest. Many of them were from Eelway, but there were still prisoners from Melisande and Fenharrow, or the isolated tribe in the White Fang Mountains. The majority of slaves went to Calicullah or Endovir, the continent's largest and most notorious labor camps, to mine for salt and precious metals. But more and more slaves were making their way into the households of Otterlin's nobility. And for Aerobin to make a filthy trade agreement, some sort of black market deal, it would sully the Assassin's Guild's entire reputation.
Believe me,
Rolf said, crossing his arms.
I have enough experience. You should be more concerned about your master. Investing in the slave trade is a guaranteed profit, but he might need to expend more of his resources than he'd like in order to keep our business from reaching the wrong ears.
Her stomach turned over, but she feigned disinterest as best she could and said,
Aerobin is a shrewd businessman. Whatever you can supply, he'll make the most of it.
For his sake, I hope that's true. I don't want to risk my name for nothing.
Rolf stood, and Selena and Sam rose with him.
I'll have the documents signed and returned to you tomorrow. For now,
he pointed toward the door.
I have 2 rooms prepared for you.
We only need one, she interrupted.
Rolf's eyebrows rose suggestively. Beneath her mask, her face burned, and Sam choked on a laugh.
1 room, 2 beds.
Rolf chuckled, striding to the door and opening it for them.
As you wish. I'll have baths drawn for you as well.
Selena and Sam followed him out into the narrow, dark hallway.
You could both use one,
he added with a wink. It took all of her self-restraint to keep from punching him below the belt.
Chapter 3. It took them 5 minutes to search the cramped room for any spy holes or signs of danger. 5 minutes for them to lift the framed paintings on the wood-paneled walls, tap at the floorboards, seal the gap between the door and the floor, and cover the window with Sam's weather-worn black cloak. When she was certain that no one could either hear or see her, Selena ripped off her hood, untied the mask, and whirled to face him. Sam, seated on his small bed, which seemed more like a cot, raised his palms to her.
Before you bite my head off,
he said, keeping his voice quiet just in case,
let me say that I went into that meeting knowing as little as you.
She glared at him, savoring the fresh air on her sticky, sweaty face.
Oh, really?
You're not the only one who can improvise.
Sam kicked off his boots and hoisted himself farther onto the bed.
That man's as much in love with himself as you are. The last thing we need is for him to know that he had the upper hand in there.
Selena dug her nails into her palms.
Why would Aerobin send us here without telling us the true reason?
Reprimand Rolf for a crime that had nothing to do with him?
Maybe Rolf was lying about the content of the letter. She straightened.
That might very well be.
He was not lying about the content of the letter, Selena,
Sam said.
Why would he bother? He has more important things to do.
She grumbled a slew of nasty words and paced. her black boots clunking against the uneven floorboards. Pirate lord indeed. This was the best room he could offer them? She was Otterlin's assassin, the right arm of Aerobin Hommel, not some backstreet harlot.
Regardless, Aerobin has his reasons.
Sam stretched out on his bed and closed his eyes.
Slaves, she spat,
dragging a hand through her braided hair. Her fingers caught in the plate.
What business does Aerobin have getting involved in the slave trade? We're better than that. We don't need that money.
Unless Aerobin was lying. Unless all of his extravagant spending was done with non-existent funds. She'd always assumed that his wealth was bottomless. He'd spent a king's fortune on her upbringing, on her wardrobe alone. Fur, silk, jewels, the weekly cost of just keeping herself looking beautiful. Of course, he'd always made it clear that she was to pay him back, and she'd been giving him a cut of her wages to do so, but maybe Aerobin wanted to increase what wealth he already had. If Ben were alive, he wouldn't have stood for it. Ben would have been as disgusted as she was. Being hired to kill corrupt government officials was one thing. But taking prisoners of war, brutalizing them until they stopped fighting back, and sentencing them to a lifetime of slavery? Sam opened an eye.
Are you going to take a bath, or can I go first?
She hurled her cloak at him. He caught it with a single hand and tossed it to the ground. She said,
I'm going first.
Of course you are.
She shot him a dirty look and stormed into the bathroom, slamming the door behind her. Of all the dinners she'd ever attended, this was by far the worst. Not because of the company, which was, she grudgingly admitted, somewhat interesting. And not because of the food, which looked and smelled wonderful, but simply because she couldn't eat anything, thanks to that confounded mask. Sam, of course, seemed to take second helpings of everything solely to mock her. Selena, seated at Rolf's left, half hoped the food was poisoned. Sam had only served himself from the array of meats and stews after watching Rolf eat some himself, so the likelihood of that wish coming true was rather low.
Mistress Sardothian, Rolf said,
his dark brows rising high on his forehead.
You must be famished. Or is my food not pleasing enough for your refined palate?
Beneath the cape, and the cloak, and the dark tunic, Selena was not just famished, but also hot and tired. And thirsty, which, combined with her temper, usually turned out to be a lethal combination. Of course, they couldn't see any of that.
I'm quite fine, she lied,
swirling the water in her goblet. It lapped against the sides, taunting her with each rotation. Selena stopped.
Maybe if you took off your mask, you might have an easier time eating,
Rolf said, taking a bite of roasted duck.
Unless what lies beneath it will make us lose our appetites.
The five other pirates, all captains in Rolf's fleet, sniggered.
Keep talking like that. Selena gripped the stem of her goblet. And I might give you a reason to wear a mask.
Sam kicked her under the table, and she kicked him back, a deft blow to his shins, hard enough that he choked on his water. Some of the assembled captains stopped laughing, but Rolf chuckled. She rested her gloved hand atop the stained dining table. The table was freckled with burns and deep gouges. It had clearly seen its fair share of brawls. Didn't Rolf have any taste for luxury? Perhaps he wasn't so well off if he was resorting to the slave trade. But Aerobin? Aerobin was as rich as the King of Otterlin himself. Rolf flicked his sea-green eyes to Sam, who was frowning yet again.
Have you seen her without the mask?
Sam, to her surprise, grimaced.
Once.
He gave her an all-too-believably wary look.
And that was enough.
Rolf studied Sam for a heartbeat, then took another bite of his meat.
Well, if you won't show me your face, then perhaps you'll indulge us with the tale of how, exactly, you became protege to Aerobin Hommel.
I trained, she said dully, for years. We aren't all lucky enough to have a magic map inked on our hands. Some of us had to climb to the top.
Rolf stiffened, and the other pirates halted their eating. He stared at her long enough for Selena to want to squirm, and then set down his fork. Sam leaned a bit closer to her, but she realized, only to see better as Rolf laid both of his hands palm up on the table. Together, his hands formed a map of their continent, and only that.
This map hasn't moved for 8 years.
His voice was a low growl. A chill went down her spine. 8 years.
exactly the time that had passed since the Fae had been banished and executed, when Otterlin had conquered and enslaved the rest of the continent, and magic had disappeared.
Don't think,
Rolf continued, withdrawing his hands,
that I haven't had to claw and kill my way as much as you.
If he was nearly 30, then he'd probably done even more killing than she had. And from the many scars on his hands and face, it was easy to tell that he'd done a lot of clawing.
Good to know we're kindred spirits, she said.
If Rolf was already used to getting his hands dirty, then trading slaves wasn't a stretch. But he was a filthy pirate. They were Aerobin Hommel's assassins, educated, wealthy, refined. Slavery was beneath them. Rolf gave her that crooked smile.
Do you act like this because it's actually in your nature? Or is it just because you're afraid of dealing with people?
I'm the world's greatest assassin. She lifted her chin. I'm not afraid of anyone.
Really? Rolf asked. Because I'm the world's greatest pirate and I'm afraid of a great number of people. That's how I've managed to stay alive for so long.
She didn't deign to reply.
Slave-mongering pig.
He shook his head, smiling in exactly the same way she smirked at Sam when she wanted to piss him off.
I'm surprised Aerobin hasn't made you check your arrogance,
Rolf said.
Your companion seems to know when to keep his mouth shut.
Sam coughed loudly and leaned forward.
How did you become Pirate Lord, then?
Rolf ran a finger along a deep groove in the wooden table.
I killed every pirate who was better than me.
The three other captains, all older, all more weathered and far less attractive than him, huffed, but didn't refute it.
Anyone arrogant enough to think they couldn't possibly lose to a young man with a patchwork crew and only one ship to his name. But they all fell, one by one. When you get a reputation like that, people tend to flock to you.
Rolf glanced between Selena and Sam.
You want my advice?
He asked her.
No.
I'd watch your back around, Sam. You might be the best Sardothian, but there's always someone waiting for you to slip.
Sam, the traitorous bastard, didn't hide his smirk. The other pirate captains chuckled. Selena stared hard at Rolf. Her stomach twisted with hunger. She'd eat later, swipe something from the tavern kitchens.
You want my advice?
He waved a hand, beckoning her to go on.
Mind your own business.
Rolf gave her a lazy smile.
I don't mind, Rolf.
Sam mused later into the pitch darkness of their room. Selena, who'd taken first watch, glared toward where his bed lay against the far wall.
Of course you don't, she grumbled, relishing the free air on her face.
Seated on her bed, she leaned against the wall and picked at the threads on the blanket.
He told you to assassinate me.
Sam chuckled.
It is wise advice.
She rolled up the sleeves of her tunic. Even at night, this rotten place was scorching hot.
Perhaps it isn't a wise idea for you to go to sleep, then.
Sam's mattress groaned as he turned over.
Come on, you can't take a bit of teasing.
Where my life is concerned? No.
Sam snorted.
Believe me, if I came home without you, Aerobin would skin me alive. Literally. If I'm going to kill you, Selena, it'll be when I can actually get away with it.
She scowled. I appreciate that. She fanned her sweating face with a hand. She'd sell her soul to a pack of demons for a cool breeze right now. But they had to keep the window covered. Unless she wanted some spying pair of eyes to discover what she looked like. Though, now that she thought about it, she'd love to see the look on Rolf's face if he found out the truth. Most already knew that she was a young woman. But if he knew he was dealing with a 16-year-old, his pride might never recover. They'd only be here for 3 nights. They could both go without a little sleep if it meant keeping her identity and their lives safe.
Selena?
Sam asked into the dark.
Should I worry about going to sleep?
She blinked, then laughed under her breath. At least Sam took her threats somewhat seriously. She wished she could say the same for Rolf.
No, she said, not tonight.
Some other night, then,
he mumbled. Within minutes, he was out. Selena rested her head against the wooden wall, listening to the sound of his breathing as the long hours of the night stretched by. Chapter 4. Even when her turn to sleep came, Selena lay awake, In the hours she'd spent watching over their room, one thought had become increasingly problematic. The slaves. Perhaps if Aerobin had sent someone else. Perhaps if it was just a business deal that she found out about later, when she was too busy to care. She might not have been so bothered by it. But to send her to retrieve a shipment of slaves? People who had done nothing wrong, only dared to fight for their freedom and the safety of their families. How could Aerobin expect her to do that? If Ben had been alive, she might have found an ally in him. Ben, despite his profession, was the most compassionate person she knew. His death left a vacancy that she didn't think could ever be filled. She sweated so much that her sheets became damp, and slept so little that when dawn came, she felt like she'd been trampled by a herd of wild horses from the Eelway grasslands. Sam finally nudged her, a none too gentle prodding with a pommel of his sword. He said, "You look horrible." Deciding to let that set the tone for the day, Selena got out of bed and promptly slammed the bathroom door. When she emerged a while later, as fresh as she could get using only the wash basin and her hands, she understood one thing with perfect clarity. There was no way, no way in any realm of hell, that she was going to bring those slaves to Rifthold. Rolf could keep them for all she cared, but she wouldn't be the one to transport them to the capital city. That meant she had 2 days to figure out how to ruin Aerobin and Rolf's deal, and find a way to come out of it alive. She slung her cape over her shoulders, silently bemoaning the fact that the yards of fabric concealed much of her lovely black tunic, especially its delicate golden embroidery. Well, at least her cape was also exquisite, even if it was a bit dirty from so much traveling.
"Where are you going?"
Sam asked. He sat up from where he lounged on the bed, cleaning his nails with the tip of a dagger. Sam definitely wouldn't help her. She'd have to find a way to get out of the deal on her own. "I have some questions to ask Rolf." Alone. She fastened her mask and strode to the door. "I want breakfast waiting for me when I return." Sam went rigid, his lips forming a thin line.
"What?"
Selena pointed to the hallway toward the kitchen.
"Breakfast," she said slowly. "I'm hungry."
Sam opened his mouth, and she waited for the retort, but it never came. He bowed deeply.
"As you wish,"
he said. They swapped particularly vulgar gestures before she stalked down the hallway. Dodging puddles of filth, vomit, and the gods knew what else, Selena found it just a tad difficult to match Rolf's long stride. With rain clouds gathering overhead, many of the people in the street, raggedy pirates swaying where they stood, prostitutes stumbling past after a long night, barefoot orphans running amok, had begun migrating into the various ramshackle buildings. Skull's Bay wasn't a beautiful city by any definition, and many of the leaning and sagging buildings seemed to have been constructed from little more than wood and nails. Aside from its denizens, the city was most famous for Shipbreaker, the giant chain that hung across the mouth of the horseshoe-shaped bay. It had been around for centuries, and was so large that, as its name implied, it could snap the mast of any ship that came up against it. While mostly designed to discourage any attacks, it also kept anyone from sneaking off. And given that the rest of the island was covered with towering mountains, there weren't many other places for a ship to safely dock. So, any ship that wanted to enter or exit the harbor had to wait for it to be lowered under the surface, and be ready to pay a hefty fee.
"You have 3 blocks, Rolf said. Better make them count."
Was he deliberately walking fast? Steadying her rising temper, Selena focused on the jagged, lush mountains hovering around the city, on the glittering curve of the bay, on the hint of sweetness in the air. She'd found Rolf just about to leave the tavern to go to a business meeting, and he'd agreed to let her ask questions as he walked.
"When the slaves arrive," she said, trying to sound as inconvenienced as possible, "will I get the chance to inspect them? Or can I trust that you're giving us a good batch?"
He shook his head at her impertinence, and Selena jumped over the outstretched legs of an unconscious, or dead, drunk in her path.
"They'll arrive tomorrow afternoon. I was planning to inspect them myself, but if you're so worried about the quality of your wares, I'll allow you to join me. Consider it a privilege."
She snorted.
"Where? On your ship?"
Better to get a good sense of how everything worked, and then build her plan from there. Knowing how things operated might create some ideas for how to make the deal fall apart with as little risk as possible.
I've converted a large stable at the other end of the town into a holding facility. I usually examine all the slaves there, but since you're leaving the next morning, we'll examine yours on the ship itself.
She clicked her tongue loudly enough for him to hear it. And how long can I expect this to take? He raised an eyebrow.
You have better things to do.
Just answer the question. Thunder rumbled in the distance. They reached the docks, which were by far the most impressive thing about the town. Ships of all shapes and sizes rocked against the wooden piers, and pirates scurried along the decks, tying down various things before the storm hit. On the horizon, lightning flashed above the lone watchtower perched along the northern entrance to the bay. The watchtower from which Shipbreaker was raised and lowered. In the flash, she'd also seen the two catapults atop one of the tower landings. If Shipbreaker didn't destroy a boat, then those catapults finished the job.
Don't worry, Miss Sardathian, Rolf said,
striding past the various taverns and inns that lined the docks. They had two blocks left.
Your time won't be wasted, though getting through 100 slaves will take a while.
100 slaves on one ship? Where did they all fit? As long as you don't try to fool me, she snapped, I'll consider it time well spent.
So you don't find reasons to complain, and I'm sure you'll try your best to do just that. I have another shipment of slaves being inspected at the holding facility tonight. Why don't you join me? That way you can have something to compare them to tomorrow.
That would be perfect, actually. Perhaps she could merely claim the slaves weren't up to par and refuse to do business with him. And then leave, no harm done to either of them. She'd still have to face Sam, and then Aerobin. But she'd figure them out later. She waved a hand. Fine, fine. Send someone for me when it's time. The humidity was so thick she felt as if she were swimming through it. And after Aerobin's slaves are inspected? Any bit of information could later be used as a weapon against him. Are they mine to look after on the ship? Or will your men be watching them for me? Your pirates might very well think they're free to take whatever slaves they wish. Rolf clenched the hilt of his sword. It glinted in the muted light, and she admired the intricate pommel, shaped like a sea dragon's head.
If I give the order that no one is to touch your slaves, then no one will touch them, Rolf said through his teeth.
His annoyance was an unexpected delight.
However, I'll arrange to have a few guards on the ship, if that will make you sleep easier. I wouldn't want Aerobin to think I don't take his investment seriously.
They approached a blue-painted tavern, where several men in dark tunics lounged out front. At the sight of Rolf, they straightened, saluting him. His guards? Why hadn't anyone escorted him through the streets? That will be fine, she said crisply. I don't want to be here any longer than necessary.
I'm sure you're eager to return to your clients in Rifthold.
Rolf stopped in front of the faded door. The sign above it, swinging in the growing storm winds, said the Sea Dragon. It was also the name of his famed ship, which was docked just behind them, and really didn't look all that spectacular anyway. Perhaps this was the Pirate Lord's headquarters. And if he was making her and Sam stay at that tavern a few blocks away, then perhaps he trusted them as little as they trusted him.
I think I'm more eager to return to civilized society, she said sweetly.
Rolf let out a low growl and stepped onto the threshold of the tavern. Inside, it was all shadows and murmuring voices, and reeked of stale ale. Other than that, she could see nothing.
One day,
Rolf said, too quietly,
someone's really going to make you pay for that arrogance.
Lightning made his green eyes flicker.
I just hope I'm there to see it.
He shut the tavern door in her face. Selena smiled, and her smile grew wider as fat drops of rain splattered on the rust-colored earth, instantly cooling the muggy air. That had gone surprisingly well.
Is it poisoned?
She asked Sam, plopping down on her bed as a clap of thunder shook the tavern to its foundations. The teacup rattled in its saucer, and she breathed in the smell of fresh-baked bread, sausage, and porridge as she threw back her hood and removed her mask.
By them, or by me?
Sam was sitting on the floor, his back against the bed. Selena sniffed all her food. Do I detect belladonna? Sam gave her a flat stare, and Selena smirked as she tore a bite from the bread. They sat in silence for a few minutes,
the only sounds the scrape of her utensils against the chipped plates, the drumming of the rain on the roof, and the occasional groan of a thunderhead breaking.
So,
Sam said,
are you going to tell me what you're planning, or should I warn Rolf to expect the worst?
She sipped daintily at her tea. I don't have the faintest idea what you're talking about, Sam Cortland.
What sort of questions did you ask him?
She set down her teacup. Rain lashed the shutters, muffling the clink of her cup against the saucer. Polite ones.
Oh, I didn't think you knew what polite meant.
I can be polite when it pleases me.
When it gets you what you want, you mean. So what is it you want from Rolf?
She studied her companion. He certainly didn't seem to have any qualms about the deal. While he might not trust Rolf, it didn't bother him that 100 innocent souls were about to be traded like cattle. I wanted to ask him more about the map on his hands.
Damn it, Selena!
Sam slammed his fist onto the wooden floor.
Tell me the truth.
Why? She asked, giving him a pout. And how do you know I'm not telling the truth? Sam got to his feet and began pacing the length of their small room. He undid the top button of his black tunic, revealing the skin beneath. Something about it felt strangely intimate, and Selena found herself quickly looking away from him.
We've grown up together. Sam stopped at the foot of her bed. You think I don't know how to tell when you're cooking up some scheme? What do you want from Rolf?
If she told him, he'd do everything in his power to prevent her from ruining the deal. And having one enemy was enough. With her plan still unformed, she had to keep Sam out of it. Besides, if worse came to worst, Rolf might very well kill Sam for being involved. Or simply for knowing her.
Maybe I'm just unable to resist how handsome he is, she said.
Sam went rigid.
He's 12 years older than you.
So?
He didn't think she was serious, did he? He gave her a look so scathing it could have turned her to ash, and he stalked to the window, ripping his cloak down.
What are you doing?
He flung open the wooden shutters to reveal a sky full of rain and forked lightning.
I'm sick of suffocating, and if you're interested in Rolf, he's bound to find out what you look like at some point, isn't he? So why bother slowly roasting to death?
Shut the window.
He only crossed his arms.
Shut it,
she growled. When he made no move to close the window, she jumped to her feet, upsetting the tray of food on her mattress, and shoved him aside hard enough for him to take a step back. Keeping her head down, she shut the window and shutters and threw his cape over the whole thing.
Idiot,
she seethed.
What's gotten into you?
Sam stepped closer, his breath hot on her face.
I'm tired of all the melodrama and nonsense that happens whenever you wear that ridiculous mask and cloak. And I'm even more tired of you ordering me around.
So that's what this was about.
Get used to it.
She made to turn to her bed, but he grabbed her wrist.
Whatever plan you're concocting, whatever bit of intrigue you're about to drag me into, just remember that you're not head of the Assassin's Guild yet. You still answer to Aerobin.
She rolled her eyes, yanking her wrist out of his grasp.
Touch me again, she said,
striding to her bed and picking up the spilled food. And you'll lose that hand. Sam didn't speak to her after that. Chapter 5. Dinner with Sam was silent, and Rolf appeared at 8 to bring them both to the holding facility. Sam didn't even ask where they were going. He just played along, as if he'd known the whole time. The holding facility was an enormous wooden warehouse, and even from down the block, something about the place made Selena's instinct scream at her to get away. The sharp reek of unwashed bodies didn't hit her until they stepped inside. Blinking against the brightness of the torches and crude chandeliers, it took her a few heartbeats to sort out what she was seeing. Rolf, striding ahead of them, didn't falter as he passed cell after cell packed with slaves. Instead, he walked toward a large open space in the rear of the warehouse, where a nut-brown Ilway man stood before a cluster of 4 pirates. Beside her, Sam let out a breath, his face wan. If the smell wasn't bad enough, the people in the cells, clinging to the bars or cowering against the walls, or clutching their children, ripped at every shred of her being. Aside from some occasional muffled weeping, the slaves were silent. Some of their eyes widened at the sight of her. She'd forgotten how she must appear. Faceless, cloak waving behind her, striding past them like death itself. Some of the slaves even sketched invisible marks in the air, warding off whatever evil they thought she was. She took in the locks on the pens, counting the number of people crammed into each cell. They hailed from all the kingdoms on the continent. There were even some orange-haired, gray-eyed mountain clansmen, wild-looking men who tracked her movements, and women, some of them barely older than Selena herself. Had they been fighters too, or just in the wrong place at the wrong time? Selena's heart pounded faster. Even after all these years, people still defied Otterlin's conquest. But what right did Otterlin, or Rolf, or anyone, have to treat them like this? Conquest wasn't enough. No. Otterlin had to break them. Ealway, she'd heard, had taken the brunt of it. Though their king had yielded his power to the king of Otterlin, Ealway's soldiers still could be found fighting in the rebel groups that plagued Otterlin's forces. But the land itself was too vital for Otterlin to abandon. Ealway boasted two of the most prosperous cities on the continent. Its territory, rich in farmland, waterways, and forests, was a crucial vein in trade routes. Now, it seemed, Otterlin had decided that it might make money off its people, too. The men standing around the Ealway prisoner parted as Rolf approached, bowing their heads. She recognized two of the men from dinner the previous night, the short, bald Captain Fairview and the one-eyed, hulking Captain Blackgold. Selena and Sam stopped beside Rolf. The Ealway man had been stripped naked, his wiry body already bruised and bleeding.
"This one fought back a bit," said Captain Fairview.
Though sweat gleamed on the slave's skin, he kept his chin high, his eyes upon some distant sight. He must have been around 20. Did he have a family?
"Keep him in irons, though, and he'll fetch a good price,"
Fairview went on, wiping his face on the shoulder of his crimson tunic. The gold embroidery was fraying, and the fabric, which had probably once been rich with color, was faded and stained.
"I'd send him to the market in Bellhaven. Lots of rich men there needing strong hands to do their building. Or women needing strong hands for something else entirely."
He winked in Selena's direction. Unyielding rage boiled up so fast, the breath was knocked from her. She didn't realize her hand was moving toward her sword until Sam knotted his fingers through hers. It was a casual enough gesture, and to anyone else, it might have looked affectionate. But he squeezed her fingers tightly enough for her to know that he was well aware of what she was about to do.
"How many of these slaves will actually be deemed useful?"
Sam asked, releasing her gloved fingers.
"Ours are all going to Rifthold, but you're dividing this batch up?"
Rolf said,
"You think your master is the first to strike a deal with me? We have other agreements in different cities. My partners in Bellhaven tell me what the wealthy are looking for, and I supply them. If I can't think of a good place to sell the slaves, I'll send them to Calicula. If your master has leftovers, sending them to Endovir might be a good option. Otterlin's stingy with what they'll offer when buying slaves for the salt mines, but it's better than making no money at all."
So Otterlin wasn't just snatching prisoners from battlefields and their homes. They were buying slaves for the salt mines of Endovir, too.
"And the children?"
she asked, keeping her voice as neutral as possible.
"Where do they go?"
Rolf's eyes darkened a bit at that, glimmering with enough guilt that Selena wondered if the slave trade had been a last resort for him.
"We try to keep the children with their mothers,"
he said quietly.
"But at the auction block, we can't control whether they're separated."
She fought the retort on her tongue and just said,
"I see. Are they a burden to sell? And how many children can we expect in our shipment?"
"We have about 10 here,"
Rolf said.
"Your shipment shouldn't contain more than that. And they're not a burden to sell, if you know where to sell them."
"Where?" Sam demanded.
"Some wealthy household might want them for scullery maids or stable boys."
Though his voice remained steady, Rolf studied the ground.
"A brothel madam might show up at the auction, too."
Sam's face went white with fury. If there was one thing that set him off, one subject she knew she could always rely upon to rile him, it was this. His mother, sold at 8 to a brothel, had spent her 2 short 28 years clawing her way up from an orphan to one of the most successful courtesans in Rifthold. She'd had Sam only 6 years before she died, murdered by a jealous client. And though she'd amassed some money, it hadn't been enough to liberate her from her brothel, or to provide for Sam. But she'd been a favorite of Arobin's,
and when he'd learned that she wanted Sam to be trained by him, he'd taken the boy in.
We'll take that into consideration, Sam said sharply.
It wasn't enough for Selena to ensure the deal fell apart. No, that wasn't nearly enough. Not when all of these people were imprisoned here. Her blood pounded in her veins. Death, at least, was quick. Especially when dealt by her hand. But slavery was unending suffering.
Very well, she said, lifting her chin.
She had to get out of here. And get Sam out of here before he snapped. A deadly gleam was growing in his eyes.
I look forward to seeing our shipment tomorrow night.
She inclined her head toward the pens behind her.
When will these slaves be sent out?
It was such a dangerous, stupid question. Rolf looked to Captain Fairview, who rubbed his dirty head.
This lot. We'll divvy them up, and they'll be loaded onto a new ship tomorrow, probably. They'll sail around the same time you do, I bet. We need to assemble crews.
He and Rolf started off on a conversation about manning the ships, and Selena took that as her cue to leave. With a final look at the slaves still standing there, Selena strode out of the warehouse that stank of fear and death.
Selena, wait!
Sam called, panting as he walked after her. She couldn't wait. She just started walking, and walking, and walking. And now, as she reached the empty beach far from the lights of Skull's Bay, she wouldn't stop walking until she reached the water. Not too far down the curve in the bay, the watchtower stood guard. Shipbreaker hanging across the water for the duration of the night. The moon illuminated the powder-fine sand and turned the calm sea into a silver mirror. She removed her mask and dropped it behind her, then ripped off her cloak, boots, and tunic. The damp breeze kissed her bare skin, fluttering her delicate white undershirt.
Selena!
Bath-warm waves flooded past her, and she kicked up a spray of water as she kept walking. Before she could get deeper than her calves, Sam grabbed her arm.
What are you doing?
He demanded. She yanked on her arm, but he held firm. In a single swift movement, she twirled, swinging her other arm. But he knew the move, because he'd practiced it right alongside her for years, and he caught her other hand.
Stop,
he said. But she swept her foot. She caught him behind the knee, sending him tumbling down. Sam didn't release her, and water and sand sprayed as they hit the ground. Selena landed on top of him, but Sam didn't pause for a moment. Before she could give him a sharp elbow to the face, he flipped her. The air whooshed out of her lungs. Sam lunged for her, and she had the sense to bring her feet up just as he leapt. She kicked him square in the stomach. He cursed as he dropped to his knees. The surf broke around him, a shower of silver. She sprang into a crouch, the sand hissing beneath her feet as she made to tackle him. But Sam had been waiting, and he twisted away, catching her by the shoulders and throwing her to the ground. She knew she'd been caught before he even finished slamming her into the sand. He pinned her wrists, his knees digging into her thighs to keep her from getting her legs under her again.
Enough!
His fingers dug painfully into her wrists. A rogue wave reached them, soaking her. She thrashed, her fingers curling, straining to draw blood, but they couldn't reach his hands. The sand shifted enough that she could scarcely get a steady surface to support herself, to flip him. But Sam knew her. He knew her movements, knew what tricks she liked to pull.
Stop,
he said, his breathing ragged.
Please.
In the moonlight, his handsome face was strained.
Please,
he repeated hoarsely. The sorrow, the defeat in his voice made her pause. A wisp of cloud passed over the moon, illuminating the strong pains of his cheekbones, the curve of his lips, the kind of rare beauty that had made his mother so successful. Far above his head, stars flickered faintly, nearly invisible in the glow of the moon.
I'm not going to let you go until you promise to stop attacking me,
Sam said. His face was inches away, and she felt the breath of every one of his words on her mouth. She took an uneven breath, then another. She had no reason to attack Sam. Not when he'd kept her from gutting that pirate in the warehouse. Not when he'd gotten so riled about the slave children. Her legs trembled with pain.
I promise, she mumbled.
Swear it.
I swear on my life.
He watched her for a second longer, then slowly eased off her. She waited until he was standing, then got to her feet. Both of them were soaked and crusted with sand,
and she was fairly certain her hair had come half out of her braid, and she looked like a raging lunatic.
So,
he said, taking off his boots and tossing them onto the sand behind them.
Are you going to explain yourself?
He rolled his pants up to the knees and took a few steps into the surf. Selena began pacing, waves splattering at her feet.
I just...
she began, but waved an arm, shaking her head fiercely.
You what?
His words were almost drowned out by the crashing waves. She whirled to face him.
How can you bear to look at those people and not do anything?
The slaves?
She resumed her pacing. It makes me sick. It makes me... makes me so mad, I think I might... She couldn't finish the thought.
Might what?
Splashing steps sounded, and she looked over her shoulder to find him approaching. He crossed his arms, bracing for a fight.
Might do something as foolish as attacking Rolf's men in their own warehouse?
It was now or never. She hadn't wanted to involve him, but now that her plans had changed, she needed his help.
I might do something as foolish as freeing the slaves, she said.
Sam went so still that he might have been turned into stone.
I knew you were thinking up something, but freeing them?
I'm going to do it with or without you.
She'd only intended to ruin the deal, but from the moment she'd walked into that warehouse tonight, she'd known she couldn't leave the slaves there.
Rolf will kill you, Sam said.
Or Aerobin will, if Rolf doesn't first.
I have to try, she said.
Why?
Sam stepped close enough that she needed to tilt her head back to see his face.
We're assassins. We kill people.
We destroy lives every day.
We have a choice, she breathed. Maybe not when we were children, when it was Aerobin or death. But now? Now you and I have a choice in the things we do. Those slaves were just taken. They were fighting for their freedom, or lived too close to a battlefield, or some mercenaries passed through their town and stole them. They're innocent people.
And we weren't.
Something icy pierced her heart at the glimmer of memory.
We kill corrupt officials and adulterous spouses. We make it quick and clean. These are entire families being ripped apart. Every one of these people used to be somebody.
Sam's eyes glowed.
I'm not disagreeing with you. I don't like the idea of this at all. Not just the slaves, but Aerobin's involvement. And those children.
He pinched the bridge of his nose.
But we're just two people, surrounded by Rolf's pirates.
She gave him a crooked grin. Then it's good that we're the best. And, she added, it's good that I've been asking him so many questions about his plans for the next 2 days. Sam blinked.
You realize this is the most reckless thing you've ever done, right?
Reckless, but maybe the most meaningful, too. Sam stared at her long enough for heat to flood her cheek, as if he could see right inside of her, see everything. The fact that he didn't turn away from whatever he saw made her blood thrum in her veins.
I suppose if we're going to die, it should be for a noble cause,
he said. She snorted, using it as an excuse to step away from him.
We're not going to die.
At least, not if we follow my plan. He groaned.
You already have a plan?
She grinned, then told him everything. When she finished, he only scratched his head.
Well,
he admitted, sitting on the sand.
I suppose that'd work. We'd have to time it right, but...
But it could work. She sat beside him.
When Aerobin finds out?
Leave Aerobin to me. I'll figure out how to deal with him.
We could always just not return to Rifthold,
Sam suggested.
What, run away?
Sam shrugged. Though he kept his eyes on the waves, she could have sworn a blush darkened his cheeks.
He might very well kill us.
If we ran away, he'd hunt us for the rest of our lives. Even if we took different names, he'd find us.
As if she could leave her entire life behind.
He's invested too much money in us, and we've yet to pay him back entirely. He'd see it as a bad investment.
Sam's gaze drifted northward, as if he could see the sprawling capital city and its towering glass castle.
I think there's more at work here than this trade agreement.
What do you mean? Sam traced circles in the sand between them.
I mean, why send the two of us here in the first place? His excuse for sending us was a lie. We're not instrumental to this deal.
He could just as easily have sent two other assassins who aren't at each other's throats all the time.
What are you implying? Sam shrugged.
Perhaps Aerobin wanted us out of Rifthold right now. needed to get us out of the city for a month.
A chill went through her. Aerobin wouldn't do that.
Wouldn't he?
Sam asked.
Did we ever find out why Ben was there the night Grigori got captured?
If you're implying that Aerobin somehow set Ben up to—
I'm not implying anything. But some things don't add up. And there are questions that haven't been answered.
We're not supposed to question Aerobin, she murmured.
And since when do you ever follow orders?
She stood.
Let's get through the next few days. Then we'll consider whatever conspiracy theories you're inventing.
Sam was on his feet in an instant.
I don't have any theories. Just questions that you should be asking yourself, too. Why did he want us gone this month?
We can trust Aerobin. Even as the words left her mouth, she felt stupid for saying them. Sam stooped to pick up his boots.
I'm going back to the tavern. Are you coming?
No. I'm staying here for a little longer. Sam gave her an appraising look, but nodded.
We're to examine Aerobin's slaves on their ship at 4 tomorrow afternoon. Try not to stay out here the whole night. We need all the rest we can get.
She didn't reply, and turned away before she could watch him head toward the golden lights of Skull's Bay. She walked along the curve of the shoreline, all the way to the lone watchtower. After studying it from the shadows, the two catapults near its top, the giant chain anchored above them. She continued on. She walked until there was nothing in the world but the grumble and hiss of the waves, the sigh of the sand beneath her feet, and the glare of the moon on the water. She walked until a surprisingly cold breeze swept past her. She halted. Slowly, Selena turned north, toward the source of the breeze, which smelled of a faraway land she hadn't seen in 8 years. Pine and snow. A city still in winter's grasp. She breathed it in, staring across the leagues of a lonely black ocean, seeing, somehow, that distant city that had once, long ago, been her home. The wind ripped the strands of hair from her braid, lashing them across her face. Orinth, a city of light and music, watched over by an alabaster castle with an opal tower so bright it could be viewed for miles. The moonlight vanished behind a thick cloud. In the sudden dark, the stars glowed brighter. She knew all the constellations by heart, and she instinctively sought out the stag, Lord of the North, and the immovable star that crowned his head. Back then, she hadn't had any choice. When Aerobin offered her this path, it was either that or death. But now, she took a shuddering breath. No. She was as limited in her choices as she'd been when she was 8 years old. She was Otterlin's assassin, Aerobin Hommel's protege and heir, and she would always be. It was a long walk back to the tavern.
Chapter 6.
After yet another miserably hot and sleepless night, Selena spent the following day with Sam, walking through the streets of Skull's Bay. They kept their pace leisurely, pausing at various vendors' carts and popping into the occasional shop, but all the while tracing each step of their plan, going over every detail that they'd need to orchestrate perfectly. From the fishermen along the docks, they learned that the rowboats tied to the piers belonged to nobody in particular, and that tomorrow's morning tide came in just after sunrise. Not advantageous, but better than midday. From flirting with the harlots along the main street, Sam learned that every once in a while, Rolf covered the tab for all the pirates in his service, and the revelry lasted for days. Sam also picked up a few other pointers that he refused to tell Selena about. And from the half-drunk pirate languishing in an alley, Selena learned how many men guarded the slave ships, what manner of weapons they carried, and where the slaves were kept. When 4 o'clock rolled around, Selena and Sam were standing aboard the ship Rolf had promised them, watching and counting as the slaves stumbled onto the wide deck. 93. Mostly men, most of them young. The women were a broader range of ages, and there were only a handful of children, just as Rolf had said.
"Do they meet your refined tastes?"
Rolf asked as he approached.
"I thought you said there'd be more,"
she replied coldly, keeping her eyes upon the chained slaves.
"We had an even 100, but 7 died on the journey."
She bit back the anger that flared. Sam, knowing her far too well for her liking, cut in.
"And how many can we expect to lose on the journey to Rifthold?"
His face was relatively neutral, though his brown eyes flashed with annoyance. "Fine.
He was a good liar. As good as she was, maybe.
Rolf ran a hand through his dark hair.
Don't you two ever stop questioning. There's no way of predicting how many slaves you'll lose. Just keep them watered and fed.
A low growl slipped through her teeth, but Rolf was already walking to his group of guards. Selena and Sam followed him, observing as the last of the slaves were shoved onto the deck.
Where are the slaves from yesterday? Sam asked.
Rolf waved a hand.
Most are on that ship, and will leave tomorrow.
He pointed to a nearby ship and ordered one of the slave drivers to start the inspection. They waited until a few slaves had been looked over, offering remarks on how fit a slave was, where he'd fetch a good price in Rifthold. Each word tasted fouler than the last.
Tonight, she said to the pirate lord, you can guarantee that this ship's protected.
Rolf sighed loudly and nodded.
That watchtower across the bay, she pressed. I assume that they'll also be responsible for monitoring this ship, too.
Yes,
Rolf snapped.
Selena opened her mouth, but he interrupted.
And before you ask, let me say that we changed the watch just before dawn.
So they'd have to target the morning watch instead, to avoid any alarm being raised at dawn, at high tide. Which was a slight hitch in her plan, but they could easily fix it.
How many of the slaves speak our language? She asked.
Rolf raised a brow.
Why?
She could feel Sam tense beside her, but she shrugged.
It might add to their value.
Rolf studied her a bit too closely, then whirled to face a slave woman standing nearby.
Do you speak the common tongue?
She looked this way and that, clutching her scraps of clothing to her. A mix of fur and wool, undoubtedly worn to keep her warm in the frigid mountain passes of the White Fangs.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Rolf demanded. The woman lifted her shackled hands. Raw, red skin lay around the iron.
I think the answer is no,
Sam offered. Rolf glared at him, then walked through the stables.
Can any of you speak the common tongue?
He repeated himself, and was about to turn back when an older Eelway man, reed thin and covered with cuts and bruises, stepped forward.
I can, he said.
That's it?
Rolf barked at the slaves.
No one else?
Selena approached the man who had spoken, committing his face to memory. He recoiled at her mask and her cloak.
Well, at least he might fetch a higher price,
Selena said over her shoulder to Rolf. Sam summoned Rolf with a question about the mountain woman in front of him, providing enough distraction.
What's your name?
Selena asked the slave.
Dia.
His long, frail fingers trembled slightly.
You're fluent?
He nodded.
My mother was from Belhaven. My father was a merchant from Banjali. I grew up with both languages.
And he'd probably never worked a day in his life.
How had he gotten caught up in this mess?
The other slaves on the deck hung back, huddling together. Even some of the larger men and women whose scars and bruises marked them as fighters, prisoners of war. Had they already seen enough of slavery to break them? For both her sake and theirs. She hoped not.
Good, she said,
and strode away. Hours later, no one noticed, or if they did, they certainly didn't care, when two cloaked figures slipped into two rowboats and headed toward the slave ships hovering several hundred yards offshore. A few lanterns illuminated the behemoth vessels, but the moon was bright enough for Selena to easily make out the golden wolf as she rowed toward it. To her right, Sam rowed as quietly as he could to the Loveless, where the slaves from yesterday were being held. Silence was their only hope and ally, though the town behind them was already in the midst of revelry. It hadn't taken long for word to get out that Aroban Hommel's assassins had opened a celebratory tab at the tavern, and even as they had strode to the docks, pirates were already streaming the other way toward the inn. Panting through her mask, Selena's arms ached with each stroke. It wasn't the town she was worried about, but the solitary watchtower to her left. A fire burned in its jagged turret, faintly illuminating the catapults and the ancient chain across the narrow bay mouth. If they were to be caught, the first alarm would be sounded from there. It might have been easier to escape now, take down the watchtower, overpower the slave ships, and set sail. But the chain was only the first in a line of defenses. The dead islands were nearly impossible to navigate at night, and at low tide, they'd get a few miles and run aground on a reef or a sandbank. Selena drifted the last few feet to the Golden Wolf,
and grasped the rung of a wooden ladder to keep the boat from thudding too hard against the hull. They were better off at first light tomorrow, when the pirates would be too drunk or unconscious to notice, and when they had high tide on their side. Sam flashed a compact mirror, indicating he'd made it to the Loveless. Catching the light in her own mirror, she signaled him back, then flashed twice, indicating that she was ready. A moment later, Sam returned the same signal. Selena took a long, steadying breath. It was time.
Chapter 7. Nimble as a cat and smooth as a snake, Selena climbed the wooden ladder built into the side of the ship. The first guard didn't notice she was upon him until her hands were around his neck, striking the two points that sent him into unconsciousness. He slumped to the deck, and she caught him by his filthy tunic, softening his fall. Quiet as mice, quiet as the wind, quiet as the grave. The second guard, stationed at the helm, saw her coming up the staircase. He managed to emit a muffled cry before the pommel of her dagger slammed into his forehead. Not as neat, and not as quiet. He hit the deck with a thud that made the third guard, stationed at the prow, whirl to see. But it was shadowy, and there were yards of ship between them. Selena crouched low to the deck, covering the fallen guard's body with her cloak.
John?
The third guard called across the deck. Selena winced at the sound. Not too far away, the Loveless was silent. Selena grimaced at the reek from John's unwashed body.
John!
The guard said, and thumping steps followed. Closer and closer. He'd see the first guard soon. 3, 2, 1.
What in hell?
The guard tripped over the first guard's prostrate body. Selena moved. She swung over the railing fast enough that the guard didn't look up until she landed behind him. All it took was a swift blow to the head, and she was easing his body down atop the first guard's. Her heart hammering through every inch of her, she sprinted to the prow of the ship. She flashed the mirror 3 times. 3 guards down. Nothing. Come on, Sam. She signaled again. Far too many heartbeats later, a signal greeted her. The air rushed from her lungs in a breath she hadn't realized she'd been holding. The guards on the Loveless were unconscious, too. She signaled once. The watchtower was still quiet. If the guards were up there, they hadn't seen anything. She had to be quick, had to get this done before her disappearance was noticed. The guard outside the captain's quarters managed to kick the wall hard enough to wake the dead before she knocked him out. But it didn't stop Captain Fairview from squealing when she slipped into his office and shut the door. When Fairview was secured in the brig, gagged and bound, and fully aware that his cooperation and the cooperation of his guards meant his life, she crept down to the cargo area. The passages were cramped, but the 2 guards at the door still didn't notice her, until she took the liberty of rendering them unconscious. Silently as she could, she grabbed a lantern hanging from a peg on the wall and opened the door. The reek almost brought her to her knees. The ceiling was so low she almost grazed it with her head. The slaves had all been chained, sitting, to the floor. No latrines, no source of light, no food or water. The slaves murmured, squinting against the sudden brightness of the torchlight leaking in from the hallway. Selena took the ring of keys she'd stolen from the captain's quarters and stepped into the cargo chamber. "Where is Dia?" she asked. They said nothing, either because they didn't understand or out of solidarity. Selena sighed, stepping farther into the chamber, and some of the wild-eyed mountain men murmured to one another. While they might have only recently declared themselves Otterland's enemies, the people of the White Fang Mountains had long been known for their unyielding love of violence. If she were to meet with any trouble in here, it would be from them. "Where is Dia?" she asked more loudly. A trembling voice came from the back of the cargo area.
"Here."
Her eyes strained to see his narrow, fine features.
"I'm here."
She strode carefully through the crowded darkness. They were so close together that there was no room to move, and hardly any air to breathe. No wonder 7 had died on the voyage here. She took out Captain Fairview's key and freed the shackles at Dia's feet, then his manacles, before offering him a hand up.
"You're going to translate for me."
The mountain folk and whoever else didn't speak either the common tongue or Eelway could figure out enough on their own.
Dia rubbed his wrists, which were bleeding and scabbed in places.
Who are you?
Selena unlocked the chains of the too thin woman beside Dia, then held out the keys in her direction. A friend, she said.
Tell her to unlock everyone, but tell them not to leave this room.
Dia nodded and spoke in Ilway. The woman, mouth slightly open, looked at Selena, then took the keys. Without a word, she set about freeing her companions. Dia then addressed the entire cargo bay, his voice soft but fierce.
The guards are unconscious, she said.
Dia translated.
The captain has been locked in the brig, and tomorrow, should you choose to act, he will guide you through the dead islands and to safety. He knows that the penalty for bad information is death.
Dia translated, his eyes growing wider and wider. Somewhere near the back, one of the mountain men began translating. And then two others translated too, one in the language of Melisande, and another in a language she didn't recognize. Had it been clever or cowardly of them not to speak up last night, when she asked who spoke the common tongue?
When I am done explaining our plan of action, she said,
her hands shaking a bit as she suddenly recalled what exactly lay before them.
You may leave this room, but do not set foot on the decks. There are guards in the watchtower, and guards monitoring this ship from land. If they see you on the deck, they will warn everyone.
She let Dia and the others finish before going on.
My colleague is already aboard the Loveless, another slave ship set to sail tomorrow.
She swallowed hard.
When I am done here, he and I will return to the town and create a distraction large enough that when the dawn breaks, you will have enough time to sail out of the harbor. You need the full day to sail out of the dead islands before dark, or else you'll be caught in their labyrinth.
Dia translated, but a woman spoke from nearby. Dia frowned as he turned to Selena.
She has two questions. What of the chain at the entrance to the bay? And how will we sail the ship?
Selena nodded.
Leave the chain to us. We'll have it down before you reach it.
When Dia and the others translated, murmurs broke out. Shackles were still thudding to the ground as slave after slave was unlocked.
As for sailing the ship, she went on above the noise. Are any of you sailors? Fishermen?
Some hands went up.
Captain Fairview will give you specific instructions. You'll have to row out of the bay, though. Everyone who has the strength will be needed on the oars, or you won't have a shot about running Rolf's ships.
What of his fleet?
Another man asked.
Leave it to me.
Sam was probably already rowing over to the Golden Wolf. They had to get back to shore now.
No matter if the chain is still up, no matter what might be happening in town, the moment the sun slips over the horizon, you start rowing like hell.
A few voices objected to Dia's translation, and he gave a sharp, short reply before turning to her.
We'll sort out specifics on our own.
She lifted her chin.
Discuss it among yourselves.
Your fate is yours to decide. But no matter what plan you choose, I will have the chain down, and will buy you as much time as I can at dawn. She bowed her head in farewell as she left the cargo hold, beckoning Dia along with her. Discussion started behind them, muffled at least. In the hallway, she could see how thin he was, how filthy. She pointed down the hall.
That is where the brig is. There you'll find Captain Fairview. Get him out before dawn, and don't be afraid to bloody him up a bit if he refuses to talk. There are three unconscious guards tied up on the deck, a guard outside Fairview's quarters, and the two here. Do whatever you want with them. The choice is yours.
I'll have someone take them to the brig,
Dia said quickly. He rubbed at the stubble on his face.
How much time will we have to get away? How long before the pirates notice?
I don't know. I'll try to disable their ships, which might slow them down. They reached the narrow stairs that led to the upper decks. There's one thing I need you to do, she continued,
and he looked up at her, his eyes bright.
My colleague doesn't speak Ilway. I need you to take a rowboat to the other ship and tell them all that I've told you and unlock their chains. We have to return to the shore now, so you'll have to go alone.
Dia sucked in a breath, but nodded.
I will.
After Dia told the people in the cargo bay to take the unconscious guards to the brig, he crept with Selena onto the empty deck. He cringed at the sight of the unconscious guards, but didn't object when she swept John's cloak over his shoulders and concealed his face in the folds of the cloak, or when she gave him John's sword and dagger. Sam was already waiting at the side of the ship, hidden from the far-seeing eyes of the watchtower.
He helped Dia into the first rowboat before climbing into the second and waiting for Selena to get aboard. Blood gleamed on Sam's dark tunic, but they both packed a change of clothes. Silently, Sam picked up the oars. Selena cleared her throat. Dia turned back to her. She inclined her head east, toward the mouth of the bay.
Remember, you must start rowing at sunrise, even if the chain is up. Every moment you delay means losing the tide.
Dia grasped the oars.
We will be ready.
Then good luck, she said.
Without another word, Dia began rowing to the other ship, his strokes a bit too loud for her liking, but not enough to be detected. Sam, too, started rowing, slipping around the curve of the prow and heading toward the docks at a casual, unsuspicious pace.
Nervous?
He asked, his voice barely audible above the steady slice of his oars through the calm bay.
No,
she lied.
Me too.
Ahead of them were the golden lights of Skull's Bay. Hoots and cheers echoed across the water. Word had certainly spread about the free ale. She smiled slightly.
Get ready to unleash hell.
Chapter 8. Though the chant of the crowd roared around them, Rolf and Sam had their eyes closed in concentration as their throats moved up and down, down and up, chugging their mugs of ale. And Selena, watching it from behind her mask, could not stop laughing. It wasn't that hard to pretend Sam was drunk and they were having the grandest time in the world. Mostly because of her mask, but also because Sam played the part very, very well. Rolf slammed his mug on the table, letting out a satisfied, ugh, and wiping his wet mouth on his sleeve as the gathered crowd cheered. Selena cackled, her masked face oozing sweat. Like every place else on this island, the tavern was suffocatingly hot, and the odor of ale and unwashed bodies poured from every crevice and stone. It was packed to capacity. A three-man ensemble made up of an accordion, a fiddle, and a tambourine played raucously in the corner by the hearth. Pirates swapped stories and called for their favorite songs. Peasants and lowlifes drank themselves into oblivion and gambled on rigged games of chance. Harlots patrolled the room, milling around tables and sitting on laps. Across from her, Rolf grinned, and Sam drained the last from his mug, or so Rolf thought. Given how often drinks were spilled and slashed, no one really noticed the constant puddle around Sam's mug, and the hole he'd drilled into the bottom of it was too small to detect. The crowd dispersed, and Selena laughed as she raised her hand.
Another round, gentlemen, she cried, signaling for the barmaid.
Well,
Rolf said,
I think it's safe to say that I prefer you like this to when we're discussing business.
Sam leaned in, a conspirator's grin on his face.
Oh, I do too. She's horrible most of the time.
Selena kicked him, hard enough, because she knew it wasn't entirely a lie, and Sam yelped. Rolf chuckled. She flipped the barmaid a copper as the woman refilled Rolf's and Sam's mugs.
So, will I ever get to see the face behind the legendary Selena Sardothian?
Rolf leaned forward to rest his arms on the sodden table. The clock behind the bar read 3:30 in the morning. They had to act soon. Given how crowded the tavern was, and how many of the pirates were already halfway unconscious, it was a miracle there was any ale left in Skull's Bay. If Arobin and Rolf didn't kill her for freeing the slaves, then Rolf might very well murder her for starting a tab with not nearly enough money to pay for it all.
She leaned closer to Rolf. If you make my master and me as much money as you claim, I'll show you my face.
Rolf glanced at the tattooed map on his hands.
Did you really sell your soul for that? She asked.
When you show me your face, I'll tell you the truth.
She extended her hand.
Deal.
He shook it. Sam raised his mug, already drained half an inch from the small hole in the bottom, and saluted their promise before both men drank. She fished out a pack of cards from a cloak pocket.
Care for a game of kings?
If you aren't beggared by the time this night is over, Rolf said, then playing against me will guarantee it.
She clicked her tongue.
Oh, I highly doubt that.
She broke and shuffled the deck three times and dealt the cards. The hours passed by in a series of clanking glasses and perfect card suites, group singing sessions and tales of lands far and near. And as the clock was silenced by the never-ending music, Selena found herself leaning into Sam's shoulder,
laughing as Rolf finished his crude and absurd story of the farmer's wife and her stallions. She banged her fist on the table, howling, and that wasn't entirely an act either. As Sam slipped a hand around her waist, his touch somehow sending a bright hot flame through her, she had to wonder if he was still pretending, too. In terms of cards, it turned out to be Sam who took them for everything they were worth, and by the time the clock hands pointed to 5, Rolf had shifted into a foul mood. Unfortunately for him, that mood wasn't about to improve. Sam gave Selena a nod, and she tripped a passing pirate, who spilled his drink on an already belligerent man, who in turn tried to punch him in the face, but hit the man next to him instead. By luck, at that moment, a trick card fell out of a man's sleeve, a prostitute slapped a pirate wench, and the tavern exploded into a brawl. People wrestled one another to the ground, some pirates drawing swords and daggers to try to duel their way across the floor. Others jumped from the mezzanine to join the fight, swinging themselves across the railing, either attempting to land on tables or aiming for the iron chandelier and missing badly. The music still played, and the musicians rose and backed farther into the corner. Rolf, half-standing, put a hand on his hilt. Selena gave him a nod before drawing her sword and charging into the brawling crowd. With deft flicks of her wrist, she cut someone's arm and ripped another's leg open, but didn't actually kill anyone. She just needed to keep the fight going and escalated enough to hold all eyes on the town. As she made to slip toward the exit, someone grabbed her around the waist and threw her into a wooden pillar so hard she knew she'd have a bruise. She squirmed in the red-faced pirate's grasp, nearly gagging as his sour breath seeped through her mask. She got her arm free enough to thrust the pommel of her sword between his legs. He dropped to the ground like a stone. Selena barely got a step away before a hairy fist slammed into her jaw. Pain blinded her like lightning, and she tasted blood in her mouth. She quickly felt her mask to ensure it wasn't cracked or about to fall off. Dodging the next blow, she swept her foot behind the man's knee and sent him careening into a yowling cluster of harlots. She didn't know where Sam had gone, but if he was sticking to the plan, then she didn't need to worry about him. Weaving through the snarls of fighting pirates, Selena headed toward the exit, clashing her blade against several unskilled swords. A pirate with a frayed eye patch raised a clumsy hand to strike her, but Selena caught it and kicked him in the stomach, sending him flying into another man. They both hit a table, flipped over it, and began fighting between themselves. Animals. Selena stalked through the crowd and out the front door of the tavern. To her delight, the streets weren't much better. The fight had spread with astonishing speed. Up and down the avenue, pouring out of the other taverns, pirates wrestled and dueled and rolled on the ground. Apparently, she hadn't been the only one eager for a fight. Reveling in the mayhem, she was halfway down the street, headed toward the meetup point with Sam, when Rolf's voice boomed out from behind her.
Enough!
Everyone lifted whatever they had in their hands, a mug, a sword, a clump of hair, and saluted. And then promptly resumed fighting. Laughing to herself, Selena hurried down an alley. Sam was already there, blood seeping from his nose, but his eyes were bright.
I'd say that went pretty well, he said.
I never knew you were such an expert card player.
She looked him up and down. His stance was steady.
Or an expert drunkard. He grinned. There's a lot you don't know about me, Selena Sardothian.
He grabbed her shoulder, suddenly closer than she'd like.
Ready?
He asked, and she nodded, looking to the lightening sky.
Let's go.
She pulled out of his grasp and yanked off her gloves, stuffing them in her pocket.
The watch at the tower must have changed by now. We've got until dawn to disable that chain and the catapults.
They'd debated for a while about whether it would be more useful to just destroy the chain from its unguarded opposite side. But even if they did, they'd still have the catapults to contend with. It was better to risk the guards and take out both the chain and the catapults at once.
If we live through this, Selena, Sam said,
heading toward the side street that led to the docks.
Remind me to teach you how to play cards properly.
She cursed colorfully enough to make him laugh and launched into a run. They turned onto a quiet street, just as someone stepped out of the shadows.
Going somewhere?
It was Rolf. Chapter 9.
Down the slope of the street, Selena could perfectly see the two slave ships sitting, still unmoving, in the bay, and the mast-snapping chain not too far from them. Unfortunately, from his angle, so could Rolf. The sky had turned light gray. Dawn. Selena bowed her head to the pirate lord. I'd rather not get my hands dirty in that mess. Rolf's lips formed a thin line.
Funny, given that you tripped the man who started the brawl.
Sam glared at her. She'd been subtle, damn it. Rolf drew his sword, the dragon's eyes gleaming in the growing light.
And also funny, since you've been spoiling for a fight for days, that you suddenly decided to vanish when everyone's attention is elsewhere.
Sam raised his hands.
We don't want any trouble.
Rolf chuckled, a harsh, humorless sound.
Maybe you don't, Sam Cortland, but she does.
Rolf stepped toward her, his sword dangling at his side.
She's wanted trouble since the moment she got here. What was your plan? Steal treasure? Information?
From the corner of her eye, something shifted in the ships. Like a bird flexing its wings, a row of oars shot out from their sides. They were ready, and the chain was still up. Don't look, don't look, don't look. But Rolf looked, and Selena's breathing turned shallow as he scanned the ships. Sam tensed, his knees bending slightly.
I am going to kill you, Selena Sardothian,
Rolf breathed, and he meant it. Selena's fingers tightened around her sword, and Rolf opened his mouth, lungs filling with air as he prepared to shout a warning. Quick as a whip, she did the only thing she could think of to distract him. Her mask clattered to the ground, and she shook off her hood. Her golden hair gleamed in the growing light. Rolf froze.
What sort of trickery is this?
Beyond them, the oars began moving, churning the water as the boats turned toward the chain and the freedom beyond it.
Go,
she murmured to Sam.
Now!
Sam only nodded before he sprinted down the street. Alone with Rolf, Selena raised her sword. Selena Sardothian, at your service. The pirate was still staring at her, his face pale with rage.
How dare you deceive me?
She sketched a bow.
I did nothing of the sort.
I told you I was beautiful. Before she could stop him, Rolf shouted,
They're trying to steal our ships! To your boats! To the watchtower!
A roar erupted around them, and Selena prayed that Sam could reach the watchtower before the pirates caught him. Selena began circling the pirate lord. He circled her too. He wasn't drunk in the least.
How old are you?
Each of his steps was carefully placed, but she noticed that he kept shifting to expose his left side. 16. She didn't bother to keep her voice low and gravelly.
Rolf swore.
Aerobin sent a 16-year-old to deal with me?
He sent the best of the best. Consider that an honor.
With a growl, the pirate lord lunged. She danced back, swinging up her sword to block the blow he aimed for her throat. She didn't need to kill him right away, just to distract him long enough to prevent him from further organizing his men, and keep him away from the ships. She had to buy Sam enough time to disable the chain and the catapults. The ships were already turning toward the mouth of the bay. Rolf launched himself again, and she let him land two strikes on her sword before she ducked the third blow and slammed into him. She swept her foot, and Rolf staggered back a step. Not missing a beat, she pulled out her long hunting knife, slashing for his chest. She let her blow fall short, ripping through the fine blue material of his tunic instead. Rolf stumbled into the wall of a building behind them, but caught his footing and dodged the blow that would have taken off his head. The vibrations of her sword hitting stone stung her hand, but she kept hold of the hilt.
What was the plan?
Rolf panted above the roar of the pirates rushing toward the docks.
Steal my slaves and take all the profit?
She laughed, feinting to his right, but sweeping for his unprotected left with her dagger. To her surprise, Rolf deflected both moves in a swift, sure motion.
To free them, she said. Beyond the chain, beyond the mouth of the bay, the clouds on the horizon began to color with the light of the coming dawn.
Fool,
Rolf spat, and this time fainted so well that even Selena couldn't avoid the rake of his sword across her arm. Warm blood seeped through her black tunic. She hissed, darting away a few steps,
A careless mistake.
You think freeing 200 slaves will solve anything?
Rolf kicked a fallen bottle of liquor at her. She knocked it aside with the flat of her sword, her right arm screaming in pain. Glass shattered behind her.
There are thousands of slaves out there. Are you going to march into Calicula and Endovir and free them, too?
Behind him, the steady strokes of the oars propelled the ships toward the chain. Sam had to hurry. Rolf shook his head.
Stupid girl. If I don't kill you, your master will.
Not giving him the luxury of a warning, she threw herself at him. She ducked, twirling, and Rolf barely turned before she slammed the pommel of her sword into the back of his head. The pirate lord crumpled to the dirt street, just as a crowd of bloodied and filthy pirates appeared around the corner. Selena only had time to throw her hood over her head, hoping the shadows concealed enough of her face, before she took off at a run. It didn't take much to get away from a group of half-drunk, battle-crazed pirates. She only had to lead them down a few twisted streets, and then she lost them. But the wound on her arm still slowed her considerably as she ran for the watchtower. Sam was already far ahead. Releasing the chain was now in his hands. Pirates raged up and down the docks, seeking any boat that was in working order. That had been the final leg of her journey last night, disabling the rudders in all of the ships along the docks, including Rolf's own ship, the Sea Dragon, which honestly deserved to be tampered with, given that security on board had been so lax. But despite the damage, some pirates managed to find rowboats and piled into them, brandishing swords or cutlasses or axes, and shouting profanities to the high heavens. The ramshackle buildings blurred as she sprinted toward the watchtower. Her breath was ragged in her throat, a night of no sleep already taking its toll. She burst past pirates on the docks, too busy bemoaning their ruined boats to notice her. The slaves still rowed for the chain, as if demons from every hell realm were upon them. Selena charged down the road, heading for the edge of the town. With the sloping, wide-open road, she could see Sam racing far ahead, and a large group of pirates not too far behind him. The cut on her arm throbbed, but she pushed herself to run faster. Sam had mere minutes to get that chain down, or else the slaves' ships would shatter upon it. Even if the slaves' ships were able to stop before they hit it, there were enough smaller boats heading out that the pirates would overpower them. The pirates had weapons. Aside from whatever was on board the ships, the slaves were unarmed, even if many of them had been warriors and rebels. There was a flash of movement from the half-crumbling tower. Steel glimmered, and there was Sam, charging up the staircase that wound up the outside of the tower. Two pirates rushed down the steps, swords raised. Sam dodged one, knocking him down with a swift strike to the spine. Before the pirate had even finished falling, Sam's blade skewered the other man clean through the middle. But there was still Shipbreaker to disable, along with the two catapults, and the dozen pirates who had now reached the foot of the tower. Selena cursed. She was still too far. There was no way she could make it in time to disable the chain. The ships would crash into it long before she got there. She swallowed the pain in her arm, focusing on her breathing as she ran and ran, not daring to take her eyes off the tower ahead. Sam, still a tiny figure in the distance, reached the top of the tower, and the expanse of open stone where the anchor to the chain lay. Even from here, she could tell it was gargantuan. And as Sam rushed around it, hacking at whatever he could, throwing himself against the enormous lever, both of them realized the horrible truth. The one thing she'd overlooked. The chain was too heavy for one man to move. The slaves' ships were close now, so close that stopping was impossible. They were going to die. But the slaves didn't cease rowing. The dozen pirates were climbing the stairs. Sam had been trained to engage multiple men in combat, but a dozen pirates? Damn Rolf and his men for delaying her. Sam glanced toward the stairs. He knew about the pirates, too. She could see everything with such maddening clarity. Sam remained atop the tower. A level below him, perched on a platform jutting out over the sea, sat the two catapults. And in the bay, the two ships that rowed with increasing speed. Freedom or death. Sam slung himself down to the catapult level, and Selena staggered a step as he hurled himself against the rotating platform on which the catapult sat, pushing, 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 until the catapult began to move. not toward the sea, but toward the tower itself, toward the spot in the stone wall where the chain was anchored. She didn't dare take her attention from the tower as Sam heaved the catapult into position. A boulder had already been loaded, and in the glare of the rising sun, she could just make out the rope stretched taut to secure the catapult. The pirates were almost at the catapult level. The two ships rode faster and faster, the chain so close that its shadow loomed over them. Selena sucked in a breath as pirates poured onto the catapult landing, weapons held high. Sam raised his sword. Light from the sunrise gleamed off the blade, bright as a star. A warning cry broke from her lips as a pirate's dagger flipped toward Sam. Sam brought his sword down on the catapult rope, doubling over. The catapult snapped so fast, she could hardly follow the motion. The boulder slammed into the tower, shattering stone, wood, and metal. Rock exploded, dust clouding the air. And with a boom that echoed across the bay, the chain collapsed, taking out a chunk of the tower, taking out the spot where she'd last seen Sam. Selena, reaching the tower at last, paused to watch as the white sails of the slave ships unfurled, glowing golden in the sunrise. The wind filled their sails and set them cruising, flying swiftly from the mouth of the bay and into the ocean beyond it. By the time the pirates fixed their ships, the slaves would be too far away to catch. She murmured a prayer for them to find a safe harbor, her words carrying on the wings of the wind, and wished them well. A block of stone crashed near her. Selena's heart gave a lurch. Sam. He couldn't be dead. Not from that dagger, or those dozen pirates, or from the catapult. No. Sam couldn't be so stupid that he'd get himself killed. She'd kill him if he was dead. Drawing her sword despite the ache in her arm, she made to rush into the half-wrecked tower, but a dagger pressed against her neck halted her in her tracks.
I don't think so,
Rolf whispered in her ear. Chapter 10.
You make a move, and I'll spill your throat on the ground,
Rolf hissed, his free hand ripping Selena's dagger from its sheath and tossing it into the brush. Then he took her sword, too.
Why not just kill me right now?
Rolf's breathy laugh tickled her ear.
Because I want to take a long, long while to enjoy killing you.
She stared at the half-ruined tower, at the dust still swirling from the catapult's destruction. How could Sam have survived that?
Do you know how much your attempt at playing hero cost me?
Rolf pushed his blade into her neck, and her skin split open with a stinging burst.
200 slaves, plus 2 ships, plus the 7 ships you disabled in the harbor, plus countless lives.
She snorted. Don't forget the ale from last night. Rolf shifted his blade, digging in and making Selena wince despite herself.
I'll take that from your flesh, too. Don't worry.
How'd you find me?
She needed time, needed something to work with. If she moved the wrong way, she'd find herself with a cut throat.
I knew you'd follow Sam. If you were so set on freeing the slaves, then you certainly wouldn't leave your companion to die alone. Though I think you arrived a bit too late for that.
In the dense jungle, the cries of birds and beasts slowly returned. But the watchtower remained silent, interrupted only by the hiss of crumbling stone.
You're going to return with me,
Rolf said.
And after I'm done with you,
I'll contact your master to come pick up the pieces. Rolf took a step, pivoting them toward the town. But Selena had been waiting. Throwing her back into his chest, she hooked her foot behind his. Rolf stumbled, tripping over her leg, and she wedged her hand between her neck and his dagger, just as he remembered to act on his promise to slit her throat. Blood from her palm splattered down her tunic, but she shoved the pain aside and butted her elbow into his stomach. Rolf's breath whooshed out of him, and he doubled over, only to meet her knee slamming into his face. A faint crack sounded as her kneecap connected with his nose. When she hurled Rolf to the dirt, blood was on her pant leg.
His blood.
She'd grabbed his fallen dagger as the pirate lord reached for his sword. He scrambled to his knees, lunging for her, but she stomped her foot down upon his sword, sending it crashing to the ground.
Rolf raised his head just in time for her to knock him onto his back. Crouching over him, she held his dagger to his neck.
Well, that didn't go the way you expected, did it? She asked,
listening for a moment to ensure no pirates were about to come crashing down the road. But the animal still hooted and screeched. The insects still hummed. They were alone. Most of the pirates were probably brawling in the town. Her hand throbbed, blood pouring out, as she grasped the collar of his tunic to lift his head closer to hers.
So, she said, her smirk widening at the blood dripping from his nose, this is what's going to happen.
She dropped his collar and fished out the two papers from inside her tunic. Compared to the pain in her hand, the injury on her arm had faded to a dull pulsing. You are going to sign these and stamp each with your seal.
I refuse.
Rolf seethed. You don't even know what they say. She pushed the tip of the dagger into his heaving throat. So allow me to clarify. One of these is a letter to my master. It says that the deal is over, that you won't be sending him slaves, and if you catch him entering into another slave trade agreement with anyone else, you'll bring your whole armada to punish him. Rolf choked.
You're insane.
Maybe, she said, but I'm not done yet. She picked up the second letter. This one?
I wrote this one for you. I did my best to write it in your voice, but you'll forgive me if it's a tad more elegant than you're used to being. Rolf struggled, but she pushed the blade a little harder, and he stopped.
Basically, she said, sighing dramatically, this one says that you, Captain Rolf, bearer of the magical map inked on your hands, will never, ever sell a slave again. And if you catch any pirates selling or transporting or trading slaves, you'll hang, burn, or drown them yourself. And that Skull's Bay is forevermore a safe haven for any slaves fleeing Otterland's clutches.
Rolf practically had steam blowing out his ears.
I won't sign either of them, you stupid girl. Don't you know who I am?
Fine, she said, angling the blade to sink into his flesh more easily. I memorized your signature when I was in your office that first day. It won't be hard to forge. And as for your seal ring,
she removed something else from her pocket. I also took that the first day in your office, just in case I needed it. Turns out I was right. Rolf croaked as she held it up in her free hand, the garnet flashing in the light.
I figure I can return to town and tell your cronies that you decided to set sail after those slaves, and to expect you back in, I don't know, 6 months, a year.
Long enough that they won't notice the grave I'll dig for you right off the road here. Frankly, you've seen who I am, and I should end your life for it.
But consider it a favor,
and a promise that if you don't follow my orders, I'll change my decision to spare you. Rolf's eyes narrowed to slits.
Why?
You'll have to clarify that.
He took a breath.
Why go to so much trouble for slaves?
Because if we don't fight for them, who will?
She pulled a fountain pen from her pocket.
Sign the papers.
Rolf raised an eyebrow.
And how will you know that I'm holding true to my word?
She removed the dagger from his throat, using the blade to brush back a strand of his dark hair.
I have my sources. And if I hear that you're trading slaves, no matter where you go, no matter how far you run, I will hunt you down.
That's twice now I've disabled you. The third time you won't be so lucky. I swear that on my name. I'm almost 17 and I can already wallop you. Imagine how good I'll be in a few years.
She shook her head.
I don't think you'll want to try me now. And certainly not then. Rolf stared at her for a few heartbeats.
If you ever set foot in my territory again, your life is forfeit.
He paused, then muttered,
May the gods help Erebin.
He took the pen.
Any other requests?
She eased off him, but kept the dagger in her hand.
Why, yes, she said. A ship would be nice.
Rolf only glared at her before he grabbed the documents. When Rolf had signed, stamped, and handed the documents to Selena, she took the liberty of knocking him out again. Swift blows to 2 points in his neck did the trick, and he'd be out long enough for her to accomplish what she needed, to find Sam. She raced up the half-crumbling stairs of the tower, leaping over pirate corpses and chunks of stone, not stopping until she found the crushed bodies of the dozen pirates who were closest to Sam and the ruins of the catapults. Blood, bone, squished bits of flesh that she didn't particularly care to look at for too long.
Sam!
She shouted, slipping over a bit of debris. She heaved a slab of wood off the side, scanning the landing for any sign of him.
Sam!
Her hand began bleeding again, leaving smears of blood as she turned over stone and wood and metal.
Where was he?
It had been her plan. If one of them had to die for it, it should have been her, not him. She reached the second catapult, its entire frame snapped in half from a fallen piece of tower. She'd last seen him here. A slab of stone jutted up from where it had hit the landing. It was large enough to have squashed someone beneath. She hurled herself against it, her feet sliding against the ground as she pushed and pushed and pushed. The stone didn't move. Grunting, gasping, she shoved harder. Still, the stone was too large. Cursing, she beat a fist against the gray surface, her injured hand aching in protest. The pain snapped something open, and she struck the stone again and again, clenching her jaw to keep the building's scream inside of her.
For some reason, I don't think that's going to make the rock move, said a voice,
and Selena whirled. Emerging from the other side of the landing was Sam. He was covered head to toe in gray dust, and blood leaked from a cut in his forehead. But he was... She lifted her chin.
I've been shouting for you!
Sam shrugged, sauntering over to her.
I figured you could wait a few minutes, given that I saved the day and all.
His brows rose high on his ash-covered face.
Some hero.
She gestured to the ruin of the tower around them. I've never seen such sloppy work. Sam smiled, his brown eyes turning golden in the dawn. It was such a Sam look. The twinkle of mischief, the hint of exasperation, the kindness that would always, always make him a better person than she was. Before she knew what she was doing, Selena threw her arms around him and held him close. Sam stiffened, but after a heartbeat, his arms came around her. She breathed him in, the smell of his sweat, the tang of the dust and rock, the metallic odor of his blood. Sam rested his cheek on her head. She couldn't remember, honestly couldn't recall, the last time anyone had held her. No, wait, it had been a year ago, with Ben, after she'd come back from a mission 2 hours late and with a sprained ankle. He'd been worried, and given how close she'd come to being captured by the royal guards, she was more than a bit shaken. But embracing Sam was different somehow, like she wanted to curl into his warmth. Like for one moment, she didn't have to worry about anything or anybody. Sam, she murmured into his chest. She peeled away from him, stepping out of his arms. If you ever tell anyone about me embracing you, I'll gut you. Sam gaped at her, then tipped his head back and laughed. He laughed and laughed until dust lodged in his throat and he launched into a coughing fit. She let him suffer through it, not finding it very funny at all. When he could breathe again, Sam cleared his throat.
Come on, Sardothian,
he said, slinging an arm around her shoulders.
If you're done liberating slaves and destroying pirate cities, then let's go home.
Selena glanced at him sidelong and grinned. The Assassin and the Healer. Chapter 1. The strange young woman had been staying at the White Pig Inn for 2 days now and had hardly spoken to anyone save for Nolan, who had taken one look at her fine night-dark clothes and bent over backward to accommodate her. He gave her the best room at the pig, the room he only offered to patrons he intended to bleed dry, and didn't seem bothered at all by the heavy hood the young woman wore, or the assortment of weapons that gleamed along her long, lean body. Not when she tossed him a gold coin with a casual flick of her gloved fingers, not when she was wearing an ornate gold brooch with a ruby the size of a robin's egg. Then again, Nolan was never really afraid of anyone, unless they seemed likely not to pay him. And even then, it was anger and greed, not fear, that won out. Irene Towers had been watching the young woman from the safety of the taproom bar. Watching, if only because the stranger was young and unaccompanied, and sat at the back table with such stillness that it was impossible not to look, not to wonder. Irene hadn't seen her face yet,
though she caught a glimpse every now and then of a golden braid glinting from the depths of her black hood. In any other city, the White Pig Inn would likely be considered the lowest of the low as far as luxury and cleanliness were concerned. But here in Inish, a port town so small it wasn't on most maps, it was considered the finest. Irene glanced at the mug she was currently cleaning and tried not to wince. She did her best to keep the bar and tap room clean to serve the pig's patrons, most of them sailors or merchants or mercenaries who often thought she was up for purchase as well, with a smile. But Nolan still watered down the wine, still washed the sheets only when there was no denying the presence of lice and fleas, and sometimes used whatever meat could be found in the back alley for their daily stew. Irene had been working here for a year now, 11 months longer than she had intended, and the White Pig still sickened her, considering that she could stomach almost anything, a fact that allowed both Nolan and Jessa to demand she clean up the most disgusting messes of their patrons. That was really saying something. The stranger at the back of the table lifted her head, signaling with a gloved finger for Irene to bring another ale. For someone who didn't seem older than 20, the young woman drank an ungodly amount. Wine, ale, whatever Nolan bade Irene bring over, but never seemed to lose herself to it. It was impossible to tell with that heavy hood, though. These past 2 nights, she'd merely stalked back to her room with a feline grace, not stumbling over herself, like most of the patrons on their way out after last call. Irene quickly poured ale into the mug she'd just been drying and set it on a tray. She added a glass of water and some more bread, since the girl hadn't touched the stew she'd been given for dinner. Not a single bite. Smart woman. Irene wove through the packed tap room, dodging the hands that tried to grab her. Halfway through her trek, she caught Nolan's eye from where he sat by the front door. An encouraging nod, his mostly bald head gleaming in the dim light.
Keep her drinking. Keep her buying.
Irene avoided rolling her eyes, if only because Nolan was the sole reason she wasn't walking the cobblestone streets with the other young women of Inish. A year ago, the stout man had let her convince him that he needed more help in the tavern below the inn. Of course, he'd only accepted when he realized he'd be receiving the better end of the bargain. But she'd been 18 and desperate, and had gladly taken a job that offered only a few coppers and a miserable little bed in a broom closet beneath the stairs. Most of her money came from tips, but Nolan claimed half of them. And then Jessa, the other barmaid, usually claimed 2/3 of what remained, because, as Jessa often said, she was
the pretty face that gets the men to part with their money anyway.
One glance into a corner revealed that pretty face, and its attendant body perched on the lap of a bearded sailor, giggling and tossing her thick brown curls. Irene sighed through her nose but didn't complain, because Jessa was Nolan's favorite, and Irene had nowhere, absolutely nowhere, left to go. Inish was her home now, and the White Pig was her haven. Outside of it, the world was too big, too full of splintered dreams and armies that had crushed and burned everything Irene held dear. Irene at last reached the stranger's table and found the young woman looking up at her.
I brought you some water and bread, too,
Irene stammered by way of greeting. She set down the ale, but hesitated with the other two items on her tray. The young woman just said,
Thank you.
Her voice was low and cool, cultured, educated, and completely uninterested in Irene. Not that there was anything about her that was remotely interesting, with her homespun wool dress doing little for her too slim figure. Like most who hailed from southern Fenharrow, Irene had golden tan skin and absolutely ordinary brown hair, and was of average height. Only her eyes, a bright gold brown, gave her any source of pride. Not that most people saw them. Irene did her best to keep her eyes down most of the time, avoiding any invitation for communication or the wrong kind of attention. So, Irene set down the bread and water and took the empty mug from where the girl had pushed it to the center of the table. But curiosity won out, and she peered into the black depths beneath the young woman's cowl. Nothing but shadows, a gleam of gold hair, and a hint of pale skin. She had so many questions. So many questions.
Who are you? Where do you come from? Where are you going? Can you use all those blades you carry?
Nolan was watching the entire encounter, so Irene curtsied and walked back to the bar through the field of groping hands, eyes downcast,
as she plastered a distant smile on her face. Selena Sardothian sat at her table in the absolutely worthless inn, wondering how her life had gone to hell so quickly. She hated Inish, hated the reek of trash and filth, hated the heavy blanket of mist that shrouded it day and night, hated the second-rate merchants and mercenaries, and generally miserable people who occupied it. No one here knew who she was, or why she'd come. No one knew that the girl beneath the hood was Selena Sardothian, the most notorious assassin in Otterland's empire. But then again, she didn't want them to know. Couldn't let them know, actually. And didn't want them knowing that she was just over a week away from turning 17, either. She'd been here for 2 days now. 2 days spent either holed up in her despicable room, a suite, the oily innkeeper had the nerve to call it, or down here in the taproom that stank of sweat, stale ale, and unwashed bodies. She would have left it if she'd had any choice, but she was forced to be here, thanks to her master, Aerobin Hommel, king of the assassins. She'd always been proud of her status as his chosen heir, always flaunted it, but now, this journey was her punishment for destroying his atrocious slave trade agreement with the pirate lord of Skull's Bay. So unless she wanted to risk the trek through the Bogdano jungle, the feral bit of land that bridged the continent to the deserted land, sailing across the Gulf of Oro was the only way, which meant waiting here, in this dump of a tavern, for a ship to take her to Yerpa. Selena sighed and took a long drink of her ale. She almost spat it out. Disgusting. Cheap as cheap could be, like the rest of this place. Like the stew she hadn't touched. Whatever meat was in there wasn't from any creature worth eating. Bread and mild cheese it was, then. Selena sat back in her seat, watching the barmaid with the brown gold hair slip through the labyrinth of tables and chairs. The girl nimbly dodged the men who groped her, all without disturbing the tray she carried over her shoulder. What a waste of swift feet, good balance, and intelligent, stunning eyes. The girl wasn't dumb. Selena had noted the way she watched the room and its patrons, the way she watched Selena herself. What personal hell had driven her to work here? Selena didn't particularly care. The questions were mostly to drive the boredom away. She'd already devoured the 3 books she'd carried with her from Rifthold, and not one of the shops in Inish had a single book for sale. Only spices, fish, out-of-fashion clothing, and nautical gear. For a port town, it was pathetic. But the kingdom of Melisande had fallen on hard times in the past 8.5 years, since the King of Otterlin had conquered the continent and redirected trade through Eelway instead of Melisande's few eastern ports. The whole world had fallen on hard times, it seemed, Selena included. She fought the urge to touch her face. The swelling from the beating Aerobin had given her had gone down, but the bruises remained. She avoided looking in the sliver of mirror above her dresser, knowing what she'd see. Mottled purple and blue and yellow along her cheekbones, a vicious black eye, and a still-healing split lip. It was all a reminder of what Aerobin had done the day she returned from Skull's Bay, proof of how she'd betrayed him by saving 200 slaves from a terrible fate. She had made a powerful enemy of the pirate lord, and she was fairly certain she'd ruined her relationship with Aerobin. But she had been right. It was worth it. It would always be worth it, she told herself. Even if she was sometimes so angry that she couldn't think straight. Even if she'd gotten into not one, not two, but 3 bar fights in the 2 weeks that she'd been traveling from Rifthold to the Red Desert. One of the brawls, at least, had been rightfully provoked. A man had cheated at a round of cards. But the other two. There was no denying it. She'd merely been spoiling for a fight. No blades, no weapons, just fists and feet. Selena supposed she should feel bad about it, about the broken noses and jaws, about the heaps of unconscious bodies in her wake. But she didn't. She couldn't bring herself to care. Because those moments she spent brawling were the few moments she felt like herself again, when she felt like Otterland's greatest assassin, Aerobin Hommel's chosen heir. Even if her opponents were drunks and untrained fighters, even if she should know better. The barmaid reached the safety of the counter, and Selena glanced about the room. The innkeeper was still watching her, as he had for the past 2 days, wondering how he could squeeze even more money out of her purse. There were several other men observing her, too. Some she recognized from previous nights,
while others were new faces that she quickly sized up. Was it fear or luck that had kept them away from her so far? She'd made no secret of the fact that she carried money with her, and her clothes and weapons spoke volumes about her wealth, too. The ruby brooch she wore practically begged for trouble. She wore it to invite trouble, actually. It was a gift from Aerobin on her 16th birthday. She hoped someone would try to steal it. If they were good enough, she might just let them. So it was only a matter of time, really, before one of them tried to rob her. And before she decided she was bored of fighting only with fists and feet, she glanced at the sword by her side. It glinted in the tavern's dank light. But she would be leaving at dawn, to sail to the deserted land, where she'd make the journey to the Red Desert to meet the mute master of assassins, with whom she was to train for a month as further punishment for her betrayal of Aerobin. If she were being honest with herself, though, she'd started entertaining the thought of not going to the Red Desert. It was tempting. She could take a ship somewhere else, to the southern continent, perhaps, and start a new life. She could leave behind Aerobin, the Assassin's Guild, the city of Rifthold, and Otterland's damned empire. There was little stopping her, save for the feeling that Aerobin would hunt her down no matter how far she went. And the fact that Sam, well, she didn't know what had happened to her fellow assassin that night the world had gone to hell. But the lure of the unknown remained, the wild rage that begged her to cast off the last of Aerobin's shackles and sail to a place where she could establish her own assassin's guild. It would be so, so easy. But even if she decided not to take the ship to Yerpa tomorrow, and instead took one bound for the southern continent, she was still left with another night in this awful inn. Another sleepless night, where she could only hear the roar of anger in her blood as it thrashed inside her. If she were smart, if she were level-headed, she would avoid any confrontation tonight and leave Inish in peace, no matter where she went. But she wasn't feeling particularly smart or level-headed. Certainly not once the hours passed, and the air in the inn shifted into a hungry wild thing that howled for blood. Chapter 2. Irene didn't know how or when it happened, but the atmosphere in the White Pig changed. It was as if all the gathered men were waiting for something. The girl at the back was still at her table, still brooding, but her gloved fingers were tapping on the scarred wooden surface, and every now and then, she shifted her hooded head to look around the room. Irene couldn't have left even if she wanted to. Last call wasn't for another 40 minutes, and she'd have to stay an hour after that to clean up and usher intoxicated patrons out the door. She didn't care where they went once they passed the threshold. Didn't care if they wound up face down in a watery ditch. Just as long as they got out of the tap room and stayed gone. Nolan had vanished moments ago, either to save his own hide or to do some dark dealings in the back alley. And Jessa was still in that sailor's lap, flirting away, unaware of the shift in the air. Irene kept looking at the hooded girl. So did many of the tavern's patrons. Were they waiting for her to get up? There were some thieves that she recognized, thieves who had been circling like vultures for the past 2 days, trying to figure out whether the strange girl could use the weapons she carried. It was common knowledge that she was leaving tomorrow at dawn. If they wanted her money, jewelry, weapons, or something far darker, tonight would be their last chance. Irene chewed on her lip as she poured a round of ales for the table of four mercenaries playing kings. She should warn the girl, tell her that she might be better off sneaking to her ship right now, before she wound up with a slit throat. But Nolan would throw Irene out into the streets if he knew she had warned her, especially when many of the cutthroats were beloved patrons who often shared their ill-gained profits with him, and she had no doubt that he'd send those very men after her if she betrayed him. How had she become so adjusted to these people? When had Nolan and the White Pig become a place and position she wanted so desperately to keep? Irene swallowed hard, pouring another mug of ale. Her mother wouldn't have hesitated to warn the girl. But her mother had been a good woman, a woman who never wavered, who never turned away a sick or wounded person, no matter how poor, from the door of their cottage in southern Fenharrow. Never. As a prodigiously gifted healer blessed with no small amount of magic, her mother had always said it wasn't right to charge people for what she'd been given for free by Silba, the goddess of healing. And the only time she'd seen her mother falter was the day the soldiers from Otterland surrounded their house, armed to the teeth and bearing torches and wood. They hadn't bothered to listen when her mother explained that her power, like Irene's, had already disappeared months before, along with the rest of the magic in the land. Abandoned by the gods, her mother had claimed. No, the soldiers hadn't listened at all, and neither had any of those vanished gods to whom her mother and Irene had pleaded for salvation. It was the first and only time her mother took a life. Irene could still see the glint of the hidden dagger in her mother's hand, still feel the blood of that soldier on her bare feet, hear her mother scream at her to run, smell the smoke of the bonfire as they burned her gifted mother alive, while Irene wept from the nearby safety of Oakwald Forest. It was from her mother that Irene had inherited her iron stomach, but she'd never thought those solid nerves would wind up keeping her here, claiming this hovel as her home. Irene was so lost in thought and memory that she didn't notice the man until a broad hand was wrapped around her waist.
"We could use a pretty face at this table," he said,
grinning up at her with a wolf's smile. Irene stepped back, but he held firm, trying to yank her into his lap.
"I've work to do,"
she said as blandly as possible. She'd detangled herself from situations like this before, countless times now. It had stopped scaring her long ago.
"You can go to work on me,"
said another of the mercenaries, a tall man with a worn-looking blade strapped to his back. Calmly, she pried the first mercenary's fingers off her waist.
"Last call is in 40 minutes,
she said pleasantly, stepping back, as far as she could without irritating the men grinning at her like wild dogs.
"Can I get you anything else?"
"What are you doing after?"
said another.
"Going home to my husband," she lied.
But they looked at the ring on her finger, the ring that now passed for a wedding band. It had belonged to her mother, and her mother's mother, and all the great women before her, all such brilliant healers, all wiped from living memory. The men scowled, and taking that as a cue to leave, Irene hurried back to the bar. She didn't warn the girl, didn't make the trek across the too big tap room, with all those men waiting like wolves.
40 minutes.
Just another 40 minutes until she could kick them all out. And then she could clean up and tumble into bed. One more day finished in this living hell that had somehow become her future. Honestly, Selena was a little insulted when none of the men in the taproom made a grab for her, her money, her ruby brooch, or her weapons as she stalked between the tables. The bell had just finished ringing for last call, and even though she wasn't tired in the slightest, she'd had enough of waiting for a fight or a conversation or anything to occupy her time. She supposed she could go back to her room and reread one of the books she'd brought. As she prowled past the bar, flipping a silver coin to the dark-haired serving girl, she debated the merits of instead going out onto the streets and seeing what adventure found her.
"Reckless and stupid,"
Sam would say, but Sam wasn't here, and she didn't know if he was dead or alive or beaten senseless by Arobin. It was a safe bet Sam had been punished for the role he'd played in liberating the slaves in Skull's Bay. She didn't want to think about it. Sam had become her friend, she supposed. She'd never had the luxury of friends, and never particularly wanted any. But Sam had been a good contender. Even if he didn't hesitate to say exactly what he thought about her, or her plans, or her abilities. What would he think if she just sailed off into the unknown and never went to the Red Desert? Or never even returned to Rifthold? He might celebrate, especially if Arobin appointed him as his heir. Or she could poach him, maybe. He'd suggested that they try to run away when they were in Skull's Bay, actually. So once she was settled someplace, once she had established a new life as a top assassin in whatever land she made her home, she could ask him to join her. And they'd never put up with beatings and humiliations again. Such an easy, inviting idea. Such a temptation. Selena trudged up the narrow stairs, listening for any thieves or cutthroats that might be waiting. To her disappointment, the upstairs hall was dark and quiet, and empty. Sighing, she slipped into her room and bolted the door. After a moment, she shoved the ancient chest of drawers in front of it, too. Not for her own safety, oh no. It was for the safety of whatever fool tried to break in, and would then find himself split open from navel to nose, just to satisfy a wandering assassin's boredom. but after pacing for 15 minutes, she pushed aside the furniture and left, looking for a fight, for an adventure, for anything to take her mind off the bruises on her face and the punishment Aerobin had given her, and the temptation to shirk her obligations, and instead, sail to a land far, far away. Irene lugged the last of the rubbish pails into the misty alley behind the White Pig, her back and arms aching. Today had been longer than most. There hadn't been a fight, thank the gods. But Irene still couldn't shake her nerves, and that sense of something being off. But she was glad, so, so glad, there hadn't been a brawl at the Pig. The last thing she wanted to do was spend the rest of the night mopping blood and vomit off the floor, and hauling broken furniture into the alley. After she'd rung the last call bell, the men had finished their drinks, grumbling and laughing, and dispersed with little to no harassment. Unsurprisingly, Jessa had vanished with her sailor, and given that the alley was empty, Irene could only assume the young woman had gone elsewhere with him, leaving her, yet again, to clean up. Irene paused as she dumped the less disgusting rubbish into a neat pile along the far wall. It wasn't much. Stale bread and stew that would be gone by morning, snatched up by the half-feral urchins roaming the streets. What would her mother say if she knew what had become of her daughter? Irene had been only 11 when those soldiers burned her mother for her magic. For the first 6.5 years after the horrors of that day, she'd lived with her mother's cousin in another village in Fenharrow, pretending to be an absolutely ungifted, distant relative. It wasn't a hard disguise to maintain. Her powers truly had vanished. But in those days, fear had run rampant, and neighbor had turned on neighbor, often selling out anyone formerly blessed with the gods' powers to whatever army legion was closest. Thankfully, no one had questioned Irene's small presence. And in those long years, no one looked her way as she helped the family farm struggle to return to normal in the wake of Otterland's forces. But she'd wanted to be a healer, like her mother and grandmother. She'd started shadowing her mother as soon as she could talk, learning slowly, as all the traditional healers did. And those years on that farm, however peaceful, if tedious and dull, hadn't been enough to make her forget 11 years of training, or the urge to follow in her mother's footsteps. She hadn't been close to her cousins, despite their charity, and neither party had really tried to bridge the gap caused by distance and fear and war. So no one objected when she took whatever money she'd saved up and walked off the farm a few months before her 18th birthday. She'd set out for Antica, a city of learning on the southern continent, a realm untouched by Otterlin and war, where rumor claimed magic still existed. She'd traveled on foot from Fenharrow, across the mountains into Melisandre, through Oakwald, eventually winding up at Inish, where rumor also claimed one could find a boat to the southern continent, to Antica. And it was precisely here that she'd run out of money. It was why she'd taken the job at the Pig. First, it had just been temporary, to earn enough to afford the passage to Antica. But then she'd worried she wouldn't have any money when she arrived, and then that she wouldn't have any money to pay for her training at the Torre Chesme, the great academy of healers and physicians. So she'd stayed, and weeks had turned into months. Somehow, the dream of sailing away, of attending the Torre, had been set aside, especially as Nolan increased the rent on her room and the cost of her food, and found ways to lower her salary, especially as that healer stomach of hers allowed her to endure the indignities and darkness of this place. Irene sighed through her nose. So here she was, a barmaid in a backwater town with hardly 2 coppers to her name, and no future in sight. There was a crunch of boots on stone, and Irene glared down the alley. If Nolan caught the urchins eating his food, however stale and disgusting, he'd blame her. He'd say he wasn't a charity and take the cost out of her paycheck. He'd done it once before, and she'd had to hunt down the urchins and scold them, make them understand that they had to wait until the middle of the night to get the food she so carefully laid out. "I told you to wait until it's past," she started, but paused as 4 figures stepped from the mist. Men, the mercenaries from before. Irene was moving for the open doorway in a heartbeat, but they were fast, faster. One blocked the door while another came up behind her, grabbing her tight and pulling her against his massive body. "Scream and I'll slit your throat," he whispered in her ear, his breath hot and reeking of ale. "Saw you making some hefty tips tonight, girl,"
Where are they?
Irene didn't know what she would have done next. Fought, or cried, or begged, or actually tried to scream. But she didn't have to decide. The man farthest from them was yanked into the mist with a strangled cry. The mercenary holding her whirled toward him, dragging Irene along. There was a ruffle of clothing, then a thump. Then silence.
Ven?
The man blocking the door called. Nothing. The third mercenary, standing between Irene and the mist, drew his short sword. Irene didn't have time to cry out in surprise or warning as a dark figure slipped from the mist and grabbed him. Not in front, but from the side, as if they'd just appeared out of thin air. The mercenary threw Irene to the ground and drew the sword from across his back, a broad, wicked-looking blade. But his companion didn't even shout. More silence.
Come out, you bleeding coward, the ringleader growled. Face us like a proper man.
A low, soft laugh. Irene's blood went cold.
Silba, protect her.
She knew that laugh, knew the cool, cultured voice that went with it. Just like how you proper men surrounded a defenseless girl in an alley. With that, the stranger stepped from the mist. She had two long daggers in her hands, and both blades were dark, with dripping blood. Chapter 3.
Gods. Oh, gods.
Alt?
Gods. Oh, gods.
Irene's breath came quickly as the girl stepped closer to the two remaining attackers. The first mercenary barked a laugh, but the one by the door was wide-eyed. Irene carefully, so carefully, backed away.
You killed my men,
the mercenary said, blade held aloft. The young woman flipped one of her daggers into a new position, the kind of position that Irene thought would easily allow the blade to go straight up through the ribs and into the heart.
Let's just say your men got what was coming to them.
The mercenary lunged, but the girl was waiting. Irene knew she should run. Run and run and not look back. But the girl was only armed with two daggers, and the mercenary was enormous, and it was over before it really started. The mercenary got in two hits, both met with those wicked-looking daggers, and then she knocked him out cold with a swift blow to the head. So fast. Unspeakably fast. And graceful. A wraith moving through the mist. He crumpled into the fog and out of sight, and Irene didn't listen too hard as the girl followed where he'd fallen. Irene whipped her head to the mercenary in the doorway, preparing to shout a warning to her savior. But the man was already sprinting down the alley as fast as his feet could carry him. Irene had half a mind to do that herself, when the stranger emerged from the mist. Blades clean, but still out. Still ready.
Please don't kill me,
Irene whispered. She was ready to beg, to offer everything in exchange for her useless, wasted life. But the young woman just laughed under her breath and said, what would have been the point in saving you then? Selena hadn't meant to save the barmaid. It had been sheer luck that she'd spotted the four mercenaries creeping about the streets. Sheer luck that they seemed as eager for trouble as she was. She had hunted them into that alley, where she found them ready to hurt that girl in unforgivable ways. The fight was over too quickly to really be enjoyable, or be a balm to her temper, if you could even call it a fight. The fourth one had gotten away, but she didn't feel like chasing him. Not as the servant girl stood in front of her, shaking from head to toe. Selena had a feeling that hurling a dagger after the sprinting man would only make the girl start screaming, or faint, which would complicate things. But the girl didn't scream or faint. She just pointed a trembling finger at Selena's arm.
You're bleeding.
Selena frowned down at the little shining spot on her bicep.
I suppose I am.
A careless mistake. The thickness of her tunic had stopped it from being a troublesome wound, but she'd have to clean it. It would be healed in a week or less. She made to turn back to the street, to see what else she could find to amuse her, but the girl spoke again.
I could bind it up for you.
She wanted to shake the girl, shake her for about 10 different reasons. The first, and biggest, was because she was trembling and scared and had been utterly useless. The second was for being stupid enough to stand in that alley in the middle of the night. She didn't feel like thinking about all the other reasons, not when she was already angry enough.
I can bind myself up just fine, Selena said,
heading for the door that led into the White Pig's kitchens. Days ago, she'd scoped out the inn and its surrounding buildings, and now could navigate them blindfolded.
Silba knows what was on that blade,
the girl said, and Selena paused, invoking the goddess of healing. Very few did that these days, unless they were.
My mother was a healer, and she taught me a few things,
the girl stammered.
Please let me repay the debt I owe you.
You wouldn't owe me anything if you'd used some common sense. The girl flinched as though Selena had struck her. It only annoyed her even more. Everything annoyed her. This town, this kingdom, this cursed world.
I'm sorry,
the girl said softly. What are you apologizing to me for? Why are you apologizing at all? Those men had it coming. But you should have been smarter on a night like this. And I bet all my money that you could taste the aggression in that filthy, damned taproom. It wasn't the girl's fault, she had to remind herself. Not her fault at all that she didn't know how to fight back. The girl put her face in her hands, her shoulders curving inward. Selena counted down the seconds until the girl burst into sobs, until she fell apart. But the tears didn't come. The girl just took a few deep breaths, then lowered her hands.
Let me clean your arm,
she said in a voice that was different somehow. Stronger, clearer.
Or you'll wind up losing it.
And the slight change in the girl was interesting enough that Selena followed her inside. She didn't bother about the three bodies in the alley. She had a feeling no one but the rats and carrion feeders would care about them in this town. Chapter 4. Irene brought the girl to her room under the stairs, because she was half afraid that the mercenary who'd gotten away would be waiting for them upstairs. And Irene didn't want to see any more fighting or killing or bleeding, strong stomach or no. Not to mention, she was also half afraid to be locked in the suite with the stranger. She left the girl sitting on her sagging bed and went to fetch two bowls of water and some clean bandages. Supplies that would be taken out of her paycheck when Nolan realized they were gone. It didn't matter, though. The stranger had saved her life. This was the least she could do. When Irene returned, she almost dropped the steaming bowls. The girl had removed her hood and cloak and tunic. Irene didn't know what to remark on first. That the girl was young, perhaps 2 or 3 years younger than Irene, but felt old. That the girl was beautiful, with golden hair and blue eyes that shone in the candlelight. Or that the girl's face would have been even more beautiful, had it not been covered in a patchwork of bruises. Such horrible bruises, including a black eye that had undoubtedly been swollen shut at some point. The girl was staring at her, quiet and still as a cat. It wasn't Irene's place to ask questions, especially not when this girl had dispatched 3 mercenaries in a matter of moments. Even if the gods had abandoned her, Irene still believed in them. They were still somewhere, still watching. She believed, because how else could she explain being saved just now? And the thought of being alone, truly alone, was almost too much to bear, even when so much of her life had gone astray. The water sloshed in the bowls as Irene set them down on the tiny table beside her bed, trying to keep her hands from trembling too much. The girl said nothing while Irene inspected the cut on her bicep. Her arm was slender, but rock hard with muscle. The girl had scars everywhere, small ones, big ones. She offered no explanation for them, and it seemed to Irene that the girl wore her scars the way some women wore their finest jewelry. The stranger couldn't have been older than 17 or 18, but Otterlin had made them all grow up fast, too fast. Irene set about washing the wound, and the girl hissed softly.
Sorry, Irene said quickly. I put some herbs in there as an antiseptic. I should have warned you.
Irene kept a stash of them with her at all times, along with other herbs her mother had taught her about, just in case. Even now, Irene couldn't turn away from a sick beggar in the street, and often walked toward the sound of coughing. Believe me, I've been through worse.
I do, Irene said. Believe you, I mean.
Those scars and her mangled face spoke volumes and explained the hood. But was it vanity or self-preservation that made her wear it?
What's your name?
It's none of your concern and it doesn't matter. Irene bit her tongue. Of course none of it was her business. The girl hadn't given a name to Nolan, either. So she was traveling on some secret business, then.
My name is Irene, she offered. Irene Towers.
A distant nod. Of course, the girl didn't care, either. Then the stranger said, What's the daughter of a healer doing in this piece of shit town? No kindness. No pity. Just blunt, if not almost bored, curiosity.
I was on my way to Antica to join their healer's academy, and ran out of money.
She dipped the rag into the water, wrung it out, and resumed cleaning the shallow wound.
I got work here to pay for the passage over the ocean, and, well, I never left. I guess staying here became easier, simpler.
A snort. This place? It's certainly simple, but easy? I think I'd rather starve in the streets of Antica.